You want to talk about loneliness or share a prayer request tonight? Maybe even a word of testimony, what God's been doing in your life. Frank is in New York listening over WAWZ. Thanks for calling us, Frank.
Good evening, gentleperson.
Evening, sir.
Anyway, I heard your topic about feeling alone, even alone in a crowd. And there are times when I feel alone in a crowd of one. And in my church, my pastor, Pastor Buzz Burbank, has stated on many occasions, I have taken drugs, I have imbibed in alcohol, I've had sex with women, but there's nothing like a good dose of Jesus Christ. And I was wondering if Jesus were alive today, if he would be listening to the Don and Mike show.
Well, that's a great question. Bless you.
Thank you. I think
the reality is, I think he'd be doing the kind of things he was doing in the New Testament.
Do you smell your own farts?
I'm sorry, sir. We really can't, have you using language like that on the air. And while we care about Frank and we pray for him, and certainly our hearts go out to him, and I'm grateful that he's involved in a church. And I want to encourage folks to pray for Frank and his own loneliness and the issues that he's dealing with in his own life, and most of all, that the Lord will be able to help him deal with some of the things that he needs to deal with.
Hey, kid, could I talk to you for about 30 seconds? This is Elvis Presley. I ask you to listen. Now, here's a song.
I hate to turn the... I hate to turn the screws.
Yes.
To my buddy.
Your buddy, your pal, your best buddy.
Here he is. He's got more than one job to do every day, but his most important job is to get the music loaded in there, so after the guy does the thing where he says, F you, beep, 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 that he goes, Don and Mike, and then we play the music. Terribly.
This is sad.
Terribly. I don't know. It's a sad day.
This is really no way to start a program.
You will please him before the day is over.
I will.
And I'm looking to Phil, and I get... That's nothing like...
There it is.
Possible thing you could grab. Ah, here's Joe. Joe.
ABM, as we call him, a beautiful mind.
OJ.
Hi. Yes, Joe's name in Pig Latin, incidentally, is OJ.
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 Sorry about that.
So you were
just one of the many technical difficulties that have been thrown in my way today.
Really?
Okay. So you're having a tough day, Joe?
Now why was
hopefully it'll settle down.
Now, Joe, I know the computers are acting up, but why is putting the C, and I don't even know where these CDs are. I do it myself. Why is that a technical difficulty?
Well, it's not a technical difficulty, but I had trouble with the best of CD earlier, and I had to revamp the entire hour.
One thing led to another.
Joe, just kind of flying by the seat of my pants.
Gentlemen, you know what I call this?
What?
A great start.
Hey, it's a three.
That's his evaluation number.
You got to forgive him. He just switched to Sanka.
Yeah, that's why he got a three on his employment. He got a three. Rob got a five.
Well, I don't know about our listeners, but I'm happy right now.
Well, then you're off the hook. Because you know what you did? This is, and you award your
way. And Joe gets credit for taking a bullet for you.
Yeah. But hold on. Is it really Joe's F-up or yours?
Technically, it is Joe's.
And that is why I love you, Rob, because look at that. Here I am ready to hurl daggers at you.
Look at how pleased he is.
And you know what you did?
What?
You immediately turned and said, not me.
I'd like to point something out, though. This is for staff cohesion right now.
Mm-hmm.
Rob did not throw Joe under the bus.
No.
Joe came in on his own.
That's
Rob was going to take the bullet for Joe.
That's right.
And that's a stand-up move, too.
That's right.
We got two guys both doing stand-up moves.
Yep. Which was going to happen, though? Were you going to rat out Joe?
Oh, I would not have ratted him
you
out.
You would not
I would have told him. I would have said,
No, I mean, I believe that. I don't think Rob had any intention of ratting Joe out, because he would have done it right up front. He's done that before.
And now we're all just wondering what it would be like just to start the show every day like this.
Yeah, so it's like it started already.
Just chatting.
It's nice, isn't it?
I like it. I mean, to me, it just gets to the good part earlier.
I like setting up the show, but before we do that, I do have to go to the phones, because I think, Robbie, I might need a timpani here.
Okay.
I should have thought to do this, because I know that we have somewhere out there right now. And boy, is this going to be a lucky individual, because we are talking right now a trip around the world.
Wow.
Oh, my God.
If you had the ticket. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hey, I've got the ticket for technical difficulties within the first 3 minutes of the show.
No, I'm sorry. Technically, you would have to say a Joe problem.
Not specific enough. Not a microphone, a Joe problem.
A Joe problem. But thanks for playing the game.
Dang.
Okay.
I'll keep trying.
Okay. Yeah. Golf, darn it.
All right, thank you.
Thanks.
Bye.
This episode deals with the inappropriateness of racial invectives and contains coarse racial slurs. Viewer discretion is advised.
Everybody loves Dynamite.
Hey, kids, could I talk to you for about 30 seconds? This is Elvis Presley. I ask you to listen. Now, here's a song.
And yes, the rumors are true. They smoke, they drink. They use bad language in mixed company. They're extremely rich, and they can flash more bling than most posses in this room. Rock stars they are, and God bless them for that.
You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Hi, Don and Mike. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Hi. Welcome to our show.
Hey, Don and Mike. Lord, you don't know could fill a book.
It's the Don and Mike show, and they'll say what they wish.
Where else would you rather be than right here, right now?
And hold on a second before, here they come. Yes, let me just take a quick call while they're saying hi. Hello, Don and Mike Show. Hello.
Hey, Don.
Yeah.
As the CEO of the company that is the Don and Mike Show, shouldn't you take responsibility for the mistake?
No, I got a golden parachute, my friend.
Oh, please.
All right, thank you.
See ya.
Bye-bye.
Incidentally,
you're never going to find a ticket that says my fault or Mike's fault on it.
Can't happen. Totally impossible. We have not printed them. And now...
Based on a true story, he was a neo-Nazi with one true enemy. Himself. A man of faith. A man of hate. And a soul torn apart. Viewer discretion advised.
How's it going so far?
Good afternoon, Mr. and Mrs. Burton Richardson and all the ships at sea. Remember, they must be your talk show host.
Yes.
And the power is only you.
Yes.
Don Geronimo and me. Wow, Mara.
Yeah. I must be your representative. There we are.
Power is with you. Well, hello and thank you for listening. Obviously, listen, it's a mess. It's the Don and Mike Show.
Good.
And it's a new episode on this Wednesday.
Wednesday.
October 29er.
Right.
It's a national show. I know it doesn't sound, I know it sounds like college radio. It's a national show.
Right.
And you can call us from anywhere in America at 877-365-3636. In Canada. that's Robbie's got a problem with Canada. I do too. 800-636-1067, the number there.
I do not.
And Washington, D.C., as always, your hotline is 202-432-1067.
Hi, Donna. Mike Buzz Burbank here.
Hi, pal. And I mean that, pal. I mean
is anyone
that.
Listening?
Hey, what happened?
Shut up.
Did you wash your ass today?
Someone called for a doctor?
You know, each and every day, it falls on deaf ear that I am part Canadian. It never registers with these two gentlemen. That's a little dagger in my heart each and every day when they
I don't
when they
against...
trash what really is partially a country that I'm connected to.
Oh, Canada.
That's all right, Mike.
Part of North America.
My grandfather's name, Oscar Perrault.
Huh?
From Canada.
Ain't that wonderful? Ain't that wonderful?
They don't care.
Why don't you just bend over and say, Hitler, come on in?
Yeah, it's always Hitler with you.
Well, hey, listen, if it's Canada, it's French related, though. It's
French and English.
It's,
yeah, it's not just
see, the
French.
Is, yeah. They really want
my
to...
grandfather was a French Canadian,
right.
Yes.
And if they really want to work their way into our good graces, and I mean this for those of you also on the other side of the border, down there at Canada South,
mm-hmm.
Down in Mexico, all you got to do is just abandon all of these ridiculous traditions and rules,
culture.
Regulations, and cultures that you have, and just everybody assimilate into the way that we do things here in America.
Don't you ever look at it the way I do, that it's just like having a nice, mellow neighbor in your neighborhood.
No.
That's the way I look at it.
No, I
don't give any trouble, really.
Well, yeah, except they like standing up for themselves, and they've got this whole thing. They've still got, do you know in Canada, they still have, I believe they still have Canadian content rules. Meaning, I'll tell you, I know everybody loves the stories about when I was coming up the ranks in radio.
Right.
Here's a great one. You'll want to get out a pencil and a piece of paper to jot this down. I'm interviewing for a job at 1050 Chum in Toronto.
Oh, yes.
C-H-U-M.
Big station.
One of the biggest top 40 stations in the world.
Yep.
And they fly me in, and Toronto is a beautiful city. And we get into the car, and they turn the radio station on, and it's Gordon Lightfoot.
Mm-hmm.
And it's Gordon Lightfoot followed by Anne Murray.
Right.
And it's Anne Murray followed by something, I think from the soundtrack of Hair, because that was written by a Canadian. And we're driving in the car to the radio station, and I'm saying, where are the top hits of today?
Mm-hmm.
Not that I'm a fan at the time of the music that was out. Not that
you better take care.
not that I'm a fan of, let's say, the Captain and Tennille.
Uh-huh.
Or
Superior, it said, never gives up for dead, and the big dick could get to
me. And I think, Elton John is another guy who I think, you know, generally played on. He said, well, we have rules that, at that time, I think it was 45 to 55% of the music had to be made by Canadian artists.
Right.
And I said, well, then you're screwed because you're playing all this junk.
Mm-hmm.
I said, but you're not playing the hits.
Right.
And they said, well, thanks for coming in for the interview. And
bye-bye.
I really never made it to the radio station.
Really?
This was the conversation.
Wow.
In the cab on the way to the radio station.
Oh, my God.
Where they just said, well, I had the attitude. They said, you'll never work here.
Well, let me throw this out. You got to like the anthem. They got a great anthem.
Oh, Canada?
Oh, Canada?
I've always been a fan of the anthem.
Yeah, it's nice.
Oh, Canada, glorious and free, we stand on guard, for thee.
Your whole rap.
I know, in this climate of super American patriotism, I may be sounding like a traitor, but I dig that anthem.
Sounds very, very traitorous.
I understand.
To mention that.
That would sound even better if you wore a red coat and got on a horse.
I like Mounties.
Now, listen, hold on, guys. Before we get sidetracked, a couple of announcements that we have to make right up front. First, well, I guess I'll wait. Well, no, this is important to everybody. God, I really should. Rob, I really needed to talk to you before the show today. Give us a moment.
Where does the time go?
All right, they're going to be a hi, Buzz.
Hi, Mike.
All right,
I
got it. Never mind.
You done?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm done. I got into my notes, and I didn't see him all day. I got here, like, in my usual time.
So much going on.
He was down here. I was up there. Buzz, do you know anything about the solar storm?
Yeah, a little.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's going to kill us all.
I know a lot about it.
This is something that
I happen to hear a very extensive report on it this morning.
The sun is giving off these fireballs.
No, they're not fireballs. They're particles,
and they're coming at us, and
electrons.
They could wreak havoc.
They could.
It probably won't.
No, that it's but
they
the danger,
could wreak havoc.
The danger has passed.
No, Mike. It was dangerous a couple of days ago, but we're going through another round right now.
Yes, and you never
know exactly what's going to happen.
I know I'm probably destroying.
Yeah. So you never know what's going to happen.
That's where you're wrong.
You see, I was kind of ruining it.
You didn't ruin the bit.
Only once in a while does he do that to me when I'm really.
Okay, we're back from the solar storm.
Independent Canadian thinking.
Yes, I know.
We're back from the solar storm. Okay, here you go. Halloween.
Uh-huh.
Here's what we're doing on Halloween. We have decided what this year's Halloween show is going to be, and I think you're going to love it. You're going to love it. First of all, on Friday, a Halloween tradition, Joe Ardinger will be trick-or-beering in the neighborhoods with his wagon. He will walk around and go door-to-door and trick-or-treat for beer. He does this every year. We love it. You'll hear that. But here in the Don and Mike broadcast headquarters, now we're going way back in the vault for this one. Mike?
Yes.
Nudity, yes, but bear with me.
Hold on. That's all I care about.
Hold on. No, yes. You're going to like it all.
All right.
The return of, because what child doesn't like a nice orange gooey cake or whatever that has marshmallows on it around Halloween? We're going to bring back the marshmallow races.
Oh, baby!
Now it's only,
baby, I am
psyched. It's only been 12 years since we did this bit.
Yes, man. Ladies and gentlemen, glue, super glue your radio dial to this radio station.
Now, here's what we will be offering you on Friday.
Mm-hmm.
You come down to Don and Mike World Broadcast Headquarters. We'll have plenty of time to talk about this between now and Friday. We're going to have a brief obstacle course in the radio station here, up and down hallways.
Right.
Now, at some point, we're going to need my man, Dennis Murphy, to phone in to come down to be part of the show. Dennis is going to be the designated
Grand Marshal.
No, he's going to have the tongs, and he's going to be placing the marshmallow. Now, because of standards and practices and the way things have changed over the last, 5 minutes that we've been working here.
Right.
We can only say that the marshmallow races are played as such, and I'm sure you'll catch along. You'll catch up as we. What you do is you bend over and you pull down your underpants and you put a marshmallow between two pillows.
The marshmallow has to be snugly between two pillows, which means the marshmallow has to be well in between the pillows.
You don't want it to fall out during the race.
Right,
exactly.
And this is what makes it so funny, not only to listen to it, but to watch, and we can put pictures on the internet this year, is that we had predominantly guys doing this contest 11 years ago, that when you're trying to run down a 20, 30, 40-yard hallway, and you've got a marshmallow in your butt, it's hard. It's hard to move around.
Now, will we be doing this with the stopwatch this year?
Yes, we will.
So each race will be an individual race. There's Charlie with the stopwatch.
We're going to use the official size marshmallow that's been sanctioned by the event.
Regulation marshmallow.
By the Marshmallow Racing Association of America.
Right.
Now you can either, you will have the option, if you want to do this, you will have the option of putting the marshmallow in yourself, or allowing Dennis Murphy to put it in with tongs. We have a cash prize of $1,000.
Wow.
For the fastest time. Now, Mike, you asked about nudity, and this is, listen, too bad, the world isn't fair, Donna Mike Show reflects life, we do have a special bonus offer for women, that if women would like to enter the contest topless, they will get an additional 5 seconds put on, taken from their time. You know what I mean?
That additional 5 seconds, that knocking 5 seconds off that time could be the difference between victory and defeat.
Okay. And also, it could mean that we have the opportunity to watch babes coming down the hallway topless, squeezing a marshmallow between their pillows, and you know, you got the bouncing of the boobs, listen, we did it 12 years ago. We did it
12 years ago, and it was absolutely fabulous.
It was.
I think we can make it better this time. We can make it better than it was before.
And they've already warned me. They've already said that, you know, and, you know, I don't know why with this company, with Infinity Broadcasting, really, with a company that is up to its eyeballs in FCC problems and in-house fighting, all of which we are thankfully saving you from now.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Trying to just focus on the show. But it's nice to know, with all the real problems this company has going legally with standards and everything else,
right,
that for whatever reason, the spotlight is still on us.
Yes.
The guys who never had anybody have sex in a church, they went back and they reviewed when we did the contest 12 years ago that, God forbid, someone, in order to win an extra prize, ate their own marshmallow.
We can't have them eat it anymore?
We have to play it by ear on Friday, but yes, we've had to tell them that the winner for extra points cannot eat their own marshmallow, but it does not mean that we still cannot have Dennis with the tongs take the marshmallow out and we can examine it.
And perhaps spontaneously, someone wanted to simply devour their marshmallow.
We can't stop them.
Right.
Yeah, we couldn't stop them either.
We can't stop them. But that's Friday.
The marshmallow races are fantastic.
Yes, that's something we've only done one time on this show.
It's time.
12 years ago.
It's time.
And it was, not only was it a great show, groundbreaking show, but
really
also
kind of a tribute to Japanese television also.
Also, at least for me, it was now I'm happy, but I used to be less than happy about the fact that this happened when my son was, if it was 12 years ago, he would have been six going on, would have been 5 or 6 years old. Anyway, he was very, very upset.
He wanted to come down here.
He wanted to play.
He called from home. He was back from pre-kindergarten or whatever it was he was going to at the time. He called up on the hotline and was just crying his head off.
Because kids, marshmallows, there's the connection.
That's right.
Kids love marshmallows.
And he wanted to win money. And he thought, well, it's my dad's show. Why can't I just come down and do the marshmallow thing? And,
right.
You know, and for years, guys would call me up after and go, hey, how's that kid of yours doing? That kid that wanted to put the marshmallow in his butt.
Was that the time he really wigged out? Where he actually screamed, or is that another call?
No, well, there was...
There was a call when he was crying in the background. But I think we put him... I think he was on and when he was really upset. And I think he was really even more mad than he was.
I don't know if he got Damien like, but I know that he wigged out.
Very upset.
He was upset about it. And anyway, he's at college now, so he won't be calling in upset about this. So
I don't think he'd want to play anyway.
So come on down. Guys and girls will be talking about this on today's show and on tomorrow's show. Anyway, the winner gets a $1,000 in cash.
That's big.
Right. And that's what we're doing for Halloween this year. Enough with the
dumb, that is fantastic.
The dumb costume contests and all the other junk.
And if you're wondering, hey, what's the tie-in? Well, the marshmallows usually end up turning orange.
Yeah, right. Wow. Right. And, you know, at least when I was a kid, sometimes you would go to people's houses, and the old lady would always put, like, four or five marshmallows.
Sure.
She'd just reach her pearl talon into the bag and put four or five marshmallows in there.
Yeah, my neighborhood, everybody handed out marshmallows. We had to pick the dust off them.
And, brother, that I have to go through it with my wife again. You know, even though now in the neighborhood that we live in, most of the kids... Mm-hmm. Most of the parents are our age, so most of the kids have moved on to college.
Grown and gone.
And we don't expect a lot of trick-or-treaters. And she went to the store over the weekend and she said, incidentally, look, I got some Kit Kats for the trick-or-treaters. And I don't care if we got one kid or five kids. She got the tiny, itsy-bitsy Dan Snyder Stewart little-sized bars. And I immediately sent her out to the store and said, this is embarrassing to me, to my doctor.
Mm-hmm. Right.
To my daughter, that we give away full size Kit Kat bars.
Full size.
Full size. So you can count on that if you're one of the four to five, perhaps six children that actually show up at my house.
I will not be purchasing Halloween candy this year.
Why?
Because it was a goose egg last year. A flat out goose egg.
Right. Nobody showed.
Yeah. I mean, I'm out in the middle of nowhere, so that's it.
So that's the deal with the marshmallow races.
I forget how you weigh in if you have like fun size, but you give like a handful.
If it's fun size, I'll give five or six.
But that's still acceptable, right?
I still stand by full size.
No, and if anything, if you really want to impress the other parents when the kids get home.
Mm-hmm.
You give away those monster size. You know, like when you go to 7-Eleven and they've got the Snickers bar.
Oh, yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Then they've got the Snickers bar that's like a Snickers bar and a half.
Yeah, right. Like a steak.
Because you know when the kids get home and they're putting the stuff on the table and the moms and the dads are looking for the ecstasy and the razor blades. At one point they're going to go, my God, this is like a bar of gold. Who gave you this gigantic?
Exactly.
And they say, it's that disc jockey.
Are you going to be giving away hams this year, Rob, again?
Oh, actually, no. This year, Carrie is finally relented, we'll be giving away literature. Full size.
So happy Halloween. Enjoy your paperback.
And for me, little bottles of absinthe.
Yes. In the pretty green color.
Yeah.
Tell your friends.
The fun size.
The marshmallow races. Marshmallow races on Friday. Now, tomorrow on the show, we got a big prize to give away. We're giving away a six-night, seven-day trip for two to Sydney, Australia, courtesy of Fox and the season premiere of True Calling.
Employees are not eligible for that.
Tomorrow night at 8, 7 Central on Fox, and we'll do something on the telephones to give that away. That's a national prize. That's a great... but we couldn't tie it into Halloween, so we're just giving that away tomorrow. Marshmallow races on Friday. I just want to say, I talk about all of you guys being my buddies, but Buzz, my buddy...
Yes.
And I want to say Buzz is a good man and a good buddy and a good friend.
Wow, that's
and
nice.
You truly are, Buzz. Well, without getting into specific...
Yeah, I don't think you should, if it's what I think it is. Yeah. Yeah, you don't want to talk about
I'll
that.
I'll talk about it on Monday.
All right, very good.
About why Buzz is a good buddy.
We'll explain it then.
Yeah. Anyway.
I agree, though. I feel the same way.
Man, is he a lifesaver. Well,
happy to do it.
It's a social obligation. That's all I'll say.
Way to keep it a secret. Way to go.
It's a social obligation.
I know.
Well, no, I mean, I'll listen.
Yeah. Well, no, you don't want to say anything about it.
Yeah, well, Monday will be good.
Yeah.
Well, it's not a surprise.
Yes, it is.
Is it really?
Yes. Oh, really?
I think so.
No, I don't think so.
I don't think so.
No, because the subject,
Eggscale,
inquired.
Guys, let me just say.
Uh-huh.
All right.
Robbie, what?
Drop it.
Yeah.
Just drop it. Talk about it Monday.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. How do you know? How do you know?
I just do.
You just do.
Right.
I just do.
Right.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll talk about it.
I'll explain to both of you.
both of you mallet heads during the break why it is, and it's pretty obvious.
But no, I'll explain to you why I don't think it is.
And, all right, well, that's fine then.
And all right, then.
As will I.
Bob, we were supposed to drop this, aren't we?
as will I, because the doesn't say that.
Right. No, but that's not the reason.
What?
All right.
What, are you going to write me a note?
Yeah, I got to write you a note.
Passing
write
me notes, a note. Passing notes in class.
Write me a note. Go ahead. I mean, if I'm right, either way, Buzz is my buddy. Stand-up guy.
Happy to do it.
Stand-up guy.
Oh, you guys.
You guys.
All right, here you go. Okay. That's the reason right there.
Oh, big deal. I don't... Is that the only reason?
That is the reason. That's what's done. I've thrown them. I've had them thrown for me. That's what it is. That's the main...
And I did the same... for my wife on the very same day, and it was not, and the RSVP went to somebody else.
Okay, but here's my note.
Oh!
So.
You win.
Okay. All right, well then,
it's done.
We're ready for the apology.
I apologize.
As do I.
No problem.
As does Rob. Rob, what did you think?
Well, I was asked about it by someone on the sales staff, and they whispered to me about it.
Well, no, see, here's the deal.
Buzz, you're sure about that?
Well, I not direct.
Now what's okay. going on?
Hold on.
Through another person, yes.
What do you mean?
You are driving me nuts now.
Another person.
So that person, Charlie, do you know what we're talking about?
Yeah, that same person asked me if I was going to be there.
So it must not...
Wait, is the person... Ask you directly.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So well, it's not.
I'm fine.
Okay. All right. But it's not a thing. And I was going to say, it doesn't say on the invitation
right.
It's a surprise party.
Right.
There's a lady who's working here, a lady who works here,
right.
and she's having a birthday party mm-hmm. this weekend. Mm-hmm. And Frida had said to me...
We might as well just bring her in.
I bet she's out on a call right now.
Yeah, probably.
Frida said to me, don't forget we're going to this lady's house, or to a house on Saturday for the for the birthday party. And I said, great. And I got to work, and I asked around, and I said, I asked Robbie yesterday. I said, "You going?" Rob said, "No, his wife's doing something with his mother, her mother, something like that." And I asked Mike, and Mike said he's got his kids, and
mm-hmm.
and you know, because here's what I'm thinking: she works. This lady works in the sales staff,
mm-hmm.
which means that all of those people back there, all of those maggots, are going to be there.
Maybe not.
Oh no, Mike! I believe
all of them.
I think
many will.
They cling together, you know, because it's that thing that they all. It's like that
right.
hug on the Mary Tyler Moore Show. I mean,
yeah,
all
the
sales people
hug.
They huddle together because they think they're strength in numbers.
Sure, of course.
They're not going to be fired if they're all together. And I think they'll all show up. And I was apprehensive that I'd be there with this lady who is very nice and her husband who's mm-hmm. been a friend for a long time, but. Let's face it, beyond that, a room full of the salespeople
mm-hmm.
and their spouses.
That's tough.
I don't know if I'm up for it, so I asked Robbie, he's not going.
Right.
Charlie's not going. I asked you, everybody's got an obligation. Finally, I went to the old reserve.
Right.
Got the thumbs up from Buzz saying, Buzz and Marsha are going.
I'll see you there.
So there
That's
you go.
Good. You guys will have a good time.
How you doing, pal?
I'm doing well.
Thanks.
Well, I'm glad that we covered that. I really thought it was.
And God bless us all for trying to keep it secret when we thought it should be.
And I really thought it was. Yeah. I didn't know.
That's a good thing.
Yeah, I don't know. There was nothing on the invitation that would lead you to believe that it was a surprise party.
Right.
and I know that when my wife turned that.
Hello, Shondell.
Hi, look who's here.
How are you?
Hey, Shondell, hi.
Hello.
How are you?
Hi, how are you?
So did you like the way we were covering this and stuff like that?
So your birthday party is not a surprise party?
No.
Okay,
good.
All right.
Good.
Very good.
No.
Are you excited?
And
there's what?
Not anymore.
Oh, no.
No. Wait a minute. Tell
but
the truth.
That's not on us.
No, it is not. You're correct.
Had the party, when the invites were, and this is important, okay?
Uh-huh.
This might help me out a little bit here.
Okay.
When the invites were sent out, was the original idea to maybe make this kind of a surprise?
No.
Okay.
All right. No.
Don, I apologize.
No
you're
problem.
Out.
No
I apologize
problem.
For thinking that it was a surprise party.
You're out.
And I apologize as well. It's the only thing I... Because when Teresa came and she said to me, are you going to Shondell's party? And I said, can't make it. I mean, why whisper it?
I think perhaps if any apology is to be made right now, it should be from you guys to Shondell since you won't be attending the party.
Wait a minute. This is the second time that you will have ditched me.
I from
are you talking to Mike?
I, from the bottom of my heart, I apologize. And are you talking about the thing at the party? The thing? No, I know. I'm on your list. I you know, and that's it. That's then. That's the otherwise
listen,
I would
now,
be there.
Just moments ago, you were there casting arrows.
I know.
Throwing arrows at all of us.
I know.
When it turns out you have a history with this woman.
I know I do. And
you disappointed her before.
Nobody in this room would rather be at that party more than me. I would love to be there, but I don't go to anything when I have my kids.
Please let the record reflect this is the first time. Time I've disappointed Sean.
Right.
All right. So it's Rob one as well. Mike two. That's it. So what's is going to be a nice shindig, huh?
It is.
Yeah.
There will not be a lot of people from the station.
You didn't invite all the sales maggots?
No.
Well, now here's the thing. Here's what we're wondering. We're thinking if I got invited. Well, and I know you're friends with Frida, so I know that's why that happened. And I know you're friends with Marcia, and I know that's why that happened. I thought you had socialized with Mike, you and your husband. That's and Rob, you're friends with Rob. So we thought, well, it just must be a mass mailing.
No,
so
you're saying absolutely not.
So there
special
are
special invitations.
So there are some people who work here who aren't invited to your birthday party.
Correct.
Wow. Fantastic. Oh,
okay. And this is a milestone birthday for you, isn't it?
It is.
You want to talk about that?
Sure, I'm catching up to you.
You are. And I'm the only reason I'm bringing that up is to set up a compliment. Because let me tell you something.
Yeah.
This is Shondell's 40th birthday party.
Unbelievable.
And Shondell looks exactly like she did when we started working with her, which was how long ago when we first time we met you?
1984.
Long time. Wow. Yeah.
Long time. So Shondell, we'll see you. Your true friends will see you.
That's right.
We'll see you.
Thank
you. Look forward to it.
You didn't need to do that. I apologize.
Sure, I
damn it.
You owe me.
You had your whole high and mighty thing that, you know, it's a surprise. And look at, she's, you know, that woman right now, the only hurt she feels is towards you, pal.
I know.
Right here.
I know.
Right here.
Right in her ticker.
I'll buy you a nice gift.
That's how Daddy fixes everything.
You have to personally pick it out. You can't send this...
RJ?
Yeah, no.
RJ did a good job.
Okay, all right. Maybe it'll be a belated gift.
Now remember, when he forgot my birthday, he did go get it, but it was a gift certificate.
Fabulous gift certificate.
Yes, it was. It was fabulous. Would that be okay?
That would be more than sufficient.
Again, you know what? Today, this very day, I will make inquiries.
Okay.
I will.
All right, Shondell.
Well,
there you go.
That'll be fun then.
So anyway,
in all seriousness, that's the big 4-0, gentlemen. I don't see it.
She doesn't look it. Not at all.
Wow.
Yeah. No, she doesn't.
She looks.
And
wonderful.
I dare you to say that in front of her husband.
Well, no, Russ would be cool with that. Russ would be happy. I've met Russ. I've hung out with Russ.
I know. Well, we all have.
Russ knows me well. Russ gave me a big hello the last time I saw him.
Oh, then he'll be disappointed too.
That I'm not there.
That you're not there.
No, I think really. What do they say in the magazine? Are 40 and fabulous.
You know what this is? You are just trying so hard to backpedal.
I am not. I mean this. I mean it has nothing to do with
that. I agree. Shondell is extremely handsome.
Yes.
There is
yes.
No doubt about it.
Yes, she looks fantastic. Yeah.
I'm hoping it's a pool party.
Oh, wouldn't that be great?
There you go. To be honest.
Yeah, not really. And if you guys haven't gotten the gifts yet, you know, may I just two words for you? Victoria's Secret.
Absolutely.
And then the password will be try it on.
Yeah. So anyway, that's what's happening. And, you know, and then there now I was feeling trepidation. Because I think, oh, well, you know, all those sales maggots like Paul Gorgie.
He's probably going to be there.
I hope he's not going to be there. And Alan and Michael and all those dicks. But I guess that it's just going to be the cool people.
I bet you'll have a great time.
The fun people.
That, you know, Shondell and her husband have come out to a couple of things that I've been to, and they're fun people. And they have some good. Fun friends, so I think you guys are going to have a good time.
Outstanding. So they've been out there to support you.
Yeah. This is true. This is very, very true. You know, I would seriously
Mike, I know
they're going if I didn't have my kids.
I understand.
Well, let me just ask you a question.
Yeah.
What would be the
I feel strangely that the heat of that spotlight is turning on me once again, and I'm getting a little nervous after yesterday.
You have to trust me here. What would be
no fallout from yesterday's show either.
What would be
yeah. Yes. Well,
did you have fallout?
No, not fallout. No, not fallout. But you know, it's funny when the Inquisition begins, people hear you and it gets back to me, and it's always fun. It's always fun to replay. It's always fun to replay the day.
You and your dates.
Yeah, yes, a date.
Okay, your date. Well,
yes.
the girl that you went to this Clinton thing with.
Mm-hmm.
And he had his picture on the front page of the style section today, so he was definitely there.
He was there, and I didn't see him, unfortunately.
He was definitely there. Mike, what about the thought. I know that your kids mean a lot to you.
Yes, they do.
You could either bring your kids with you,
mm-hmm.
or you could find somebody to watch your kids for a couple of hours, because Shondell's been such a good friend.
There are those crunchy buttons.
You know, we're not going to...
What time does the party start?
I don't know. You know, we're gonna drop the whole topic. Sunspot
is killing us.
Damn it!
Steve, Mike, help! Mike, help!
Mike. All right. Well, we'll have to get to it another time. No, your kids come first.
Yeah, especially this weekend. It's a big weekend.
Yeah, Halloween and all.
Right, Halloween. Friday.
Mm-hmm.
The party's Saturday. But I know, you've got your kids on the weekend. I'm busting your
What time does the party start? Some of those parties, I didn't even check. Some of those parties are kids' parties, but this is a grown-up party.
Oh, no.
It starts like at 8 o'clock at night.
No, this is a sex toys party.
Yeah. Very adult.
And I think it's 7 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's 7 o'clock.
Clothing, yeah, that's
optional, from what I read.
Yeah, that's an hour and a half before bedtime.
Clothing optional. And group hug, group swim, group...
on the plank.
Yeah, it's going to be crazy. It's going to be nuts.
Adult swim. I'm Cartoon Network.
So anyway, thank you, Buzz.
Thank you.
But I didn't have to thank you because it turns out the maggots won't be there. All the maggots won't be there.
And even if they are, we have each other.
Yes, we do.
You guys will have a good time now.
Fantastic. And you know what else this means? And I think I can say this now. I don't think my wife's listening. And I don't think your wife's listening.
Right, right.
What this means? Great news for Buzz and I.
Right.
Now we can just pawn our wives on each other's
there
wives.
There you go.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. There you go.
Yep. And you can just mingle.
That's how you go to a party.
That's
what we want to do.
You go to the party, you go, hey, oh Frida, look, there's Marcia.
Mm-hmm.
And then as soon as that connection is made.
The attention's turned.
Boom, absolutely.
You're gone. You're out of there.
You are gone.
You are gone.
You are gone.
Okay, we've not talked about 24. We'll do that in just a second here.
How was it?
I'll tell you in a minute.
Okay.
From Sacramento. I got a story here from July that I can't believe we didn't get about perhaps the most pussy-whipped man ever. More pussy-whipped than me?
Really?
More pussy-whipped than Rob?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, anyway, and he's a basketball player. I don't know if it's true or not. We'll get to that in a second.
Mm.
Oh, Christing, time is gone. We got a break.
Wow.
We'll be right back.
Happy birthday.
It's the Don and Mike Show.
You can't go to China. What about your job?
My job?
No, write a letter, move to another borough. Move to Staten Island. It's a lot easier to blend into a sea of people in Staten Island than China, believe me.
Yeah, Staten Island. What about my clothes? How do I get the rest of the clothes?
Well, you come back for your clothes.
I'm not going back in there.
So forget about your clothes.
Well, I'm not starting up a whole new wardrobe now!
Look, freedom and no clothes is a lot better than no freedom with clothes.
Well, should we just take a plane somewhere?
And what, hope for a crash?
It happens.
You know what the odds are on a crash? It's 1,000,000 to 1.
It's something. It's hope.
The Don and Mike Show. They like holes, not pole. Don and Mike.
All right. Okay. Gosh, phone calls, 24, pussy whip. You didn't see 24, you didn't watch the TiVo yet?
My TiVo is effed up.
Ooh.
I was all set to watch it today, and I don't have TiVo.
Wow. I liked it. It was nice with no commercials.
Mm-hmm.
However, let me just say this. You know, I'm torn because I'm a fan of the show, and I'm sure that it'll get right up to speed, but... It's 3 years later. The new season is 3 years later.
So it takes place after a lot of the dust has settled from the previous episode.
Like almost all the people at CTU are dead, except for his just piece of ass daughter who now works there.
That to me, I mean, if they brought her back, that saves the show.
And the moon faced girl is still there.
Yeah, the moon faced girl's there, and she's married to the other guy, Tony. She's married to him now.
Alicia Cuthbert is the daughter.
That's the daughter. But the president is there.
Mm-hmm.
He has something funky on his hand from when they put that acid on his hand.
So he's got like a scar now?
Something. And they had to put like some Star Trek device on him to monitor his blood pressure.
He may not be completely well, but he's back in office.
Okay.
But here's the only fault that I have with last night's episode. why is everything happening in Southern California? That I know that's where CTU, where Jack Bauer works, that's where it is. But
CTU Los Angeles.
But terrorism is everywhere, and as it turns out, by coincidence, the president has come for the first time in 3 years since he was burned with the acid.
Come back to California.
He's come back to Southern California, mm-hmm. And by coincidence, it's on the exact same day as a drug dealer who got Jack Bauer hooked on heroin, who he put away.
Right.
But he had to get hooked on heroin to convince the guy that he was with him.
Mm-hmm.
It's on that same day that the president arrives back, and a virus is being spread through Los Angeles that can kill everybody.
Have they worked Arnold Schwarzenegger? Schwarzenegger into the plots in California.
I have not.
Didn't you get the impression that they maybe planned the virus outbreak while the president was there? Because it was a debate. It was something that was planned months in advance, so they knew he would be there. It was his first trip to L.A.
Rob, I'm being overly critical and sensitive about the show that I love so much.
Right.
Just thinking, is it that much? For instance, CSI Miami. Mm-hmm. Do you know where they filmed that show? In Burbank, California.
Right.
Here's what they do. For 3 days, they send everybody out to Miami.
Right.
And they same with CSI Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they have them take the pictures in front of the landmarks.
Right.
And then they go back to Hollywood and make their magic.
Right.
So
it's really pretty intricate, I mean, the way they do that, because they have to have the right shots that tie into the episodes, and it's a lot of advanced planning.
It's just it's a lot of Los Angeles, again, and it seems to be a similar plot to last year's, but I'll watch it.
Most important question, the Jack Bauer's daughter. What did she wear last night? Did she wear anything provocative?
You'd be very, very disappointed. Well, she wore business suits.
Oh.
And she's dating some skinhead. He's not a skinhead. He's got a close-cropped, a crew cut, a guy who works at CTU. And the guy works, incidentally, with Jack Bauer. So a lot of the hour was this guy trying to get the nerve to tell Jack Bauer that even though he's Jack Bauer's partner and
right.
Jack Bauer is his mentor,
right.
that he's boning his daughter.
Okay.
He was never able to do it. And
so there was no actual boning.
And Jack's on smack.
So he's still on heroin?
Yeah. At one point, he closed all the blinds to his office and he did that thing with the rubber.
The tourniquet.
Right,
right.
Thing, yeah. And he was
the
on
tourniquet. You knew the name for it.
Yeah, a little too quickly, wasn't it?
It's a big, gigantic rubber band.
And Hank Kingsley's former assistant is now Jack Bauer's secretary, which I thought was interesting.
That's right. Remember the girl from Larry Sanders who took Darlene's place? Remember the kind of dumb.
Ditsy?
Dumb.
Yeah. That's not good casting.
Doesn't look too bright.
Yeah, but here's the thing, and I'll give them a pass on that, because they had Roseanne's daughter on there.
Right.
And when I originally saw Roseanne's daughter, I went, ugh. But she ended up being all right on the show until she was dead.
Yeah. They killed her off early on.
Yeah.
So what do you give it?
I'd give it, because I'm a fan, I'd give it 7.5 out of 10.
Okay.
I would have said 7, yeah.
Yeah.
Joe gives it a 3.
Joe Ardinger?
Yeah, he gives everything a 3.
Oh, right, because that's his grade. Right.
And on a scale of 5 or 10, it's always a 3.
That's Joe. He's the 3 guy. But what is nice is the fact that there were no commercials during the hour, and they had a pretty interesting, well-done commercial for Ford that starred Kiefer Sutherland at the beginning and at the very end, but I couldn't help but notice how much product placement there was during the show. For instance, every time either a bad guy or a good guy got into a truck, you couldn't help but notice that gigantic Ford logo.
Probably a little bigger than normal.
Mm-hmm. Staring out at you, but yeah, I'll stick with it.
And Alicia Cuthbert's new haircut makes her look, I think, a little like a young, not worn out yet Debbie Harry.
Yeah,
real.
Yeah, she does. Yeah. She does have the definitely the bleach blonde look happening.
Little curls.
No, it's a flip, sort of.
Yeah, you'll see it.
Mm-hmm. It's straight. It's, you know, the girls iron their hair, whatever it is that they do to make it so that it's not curly. But
right.
I don't know. Yeah, I liked it.
Alicia Cuthbert.
I liked it. I'll stick with it.
Yeah.
You know, it's one of those few shows you get. It's like that in The Sopranos. You get excited about those shows coming
back. It's nice to have those, especially with all the crap that's on.
Yeah.
And, you know, he did. Kiefer Sutherland came out at the beginning and, you know, said, well, hi, welcome to the new season.
Previously on 24.
I want to thank the people at Ford for, and now please enjoy 24.
24.
The following events happen between 1 a.m. and 1 p.m. or whatever it is that he says.
I'm Jack Bauer.
Anyway.
Don't you understand?
And there was none of that. No, I take it back. Yeah, he does.
Yeah,
he still only acts at two speeds. It's either
previously on 24.
And when he was...
he got cranky when he was jonesing.
Yeah, he was he was crankiest, he was angriest when he needed his heroin.
Right? I needed his fix.
Yeah. See, now at that I didn't know...
I need my medication.
I didn't know if... because I had read that something was going to happen to Jack, and I didn't know if he was going to be sick.
Right.
And so I was thinking he was sick, and he's like, he's gutting it out.
Yeah, I didn't know until we saw him.
Mr. President, I think we're going to have to cancel the marshmallow races.
wrong again? Brandon.
Yes, the Ford commercial, the point of it, Keith or Sutherland wasn't in it.
He was not. It was a they had a like a look-alike, sound-alike guy.
Well,
but
all right. Well,
yeah, it was supposed to be his character, yeah, Jack Bauer.
Hello?
He wanted to correct and then be mean about it.
Yeah.
Because he's a mean-spirited
that's
man.
What it is. I can take it. Mm-hmm. I didn't get it right, okay?
Not a big deal.
A-hole. J-off. C-U. Oh. You know, word avid drinker.
Absolutely.
A-effer.
Previously with the last caller.
No, I was only half watching that anyway. You could have been absolutely right. But to my dumb, untrained eye, it looked like Kiefer Sutherland.
And that's what they wanted to accomplish.
There you go. Yeah. So
he's still in a bad mood, basically.
Yes.
Yeah, whenever he needs his fix. Sure.
Constantly. Yeah. But he was in a bad mood the whole time, though.
Yeah. Now, last year there was no heroin, and the year before, was there heroin?
No, but you're going to...
So heroin is new this year.
You're going to love this, though, Mike, and because I know you love this movie like I do.
Right.
Clear and Present Danger.
Oh, yes.
All right. You know the guy that Harrison Ford, there's the fat Mexican guy or Guatemalan guy, whoever he is, the guy that takes batting practice in that movie. The guy,
yeah, I know. He's a very, very famous Latin character.
The guy who runs the cartel.
Right.
All right. Well, in Clear and Present Danger... The guy who was the middleman?
Yes, the evil Latin guy.
The kind of good-looking Latin guy?
Yeah, he's a great actor.
Harrison Ford ends up getting in a fight with in the end?
Yeah, he is a terrific actor.
Mm-hmm. He's the bad guy.
Oh, that guy's kind of slick, you know?
He's the bad guy who got Jack hooked on the smack.
And now he's paying him back, huh?
Yeah.
That's good.
Pretty good.
I like that. That's good.
Pretty good. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
John Power.
Dave.
Howdy.
Dave calling from Modesto, near Sacramento, but not really Sacramento.
Dave, I'm sorry. Simply, my friend, too much information. Simply too much. It's okay to say where you are and where you're calling from.
No need to give us a disclaimer.
Yeah. Hi, Don and Mike Show.
Yeah, now Buzz is wrong.
Now Buzz is wrong. Why?
What am I wrong about?
Well, see, the story of that Ford commercial thing was the guy was supposed to be... His last name was Bauer, and his first name was something else.
It turned out to be Jeff Bauer, and yes, I do know what was going on, but we were supposed to think it was Jack Bauer.
Okay. Anybody actually watch the show? Hello, Don.
I tell you, that commercial got great placement because everybody's paying attention to it.
Yeah. Hello, Don and Mike.
Yeah, Radio God.
Howdy.
How are you doing?
We're doing great, thanks.
Great. I want to give you a piece of information coming up in the next couple of episodes. There's a great POA coming on. You guys know who Andrea Thompson?
And how do you know that she's coming on?
I read in TV Guide.
From NYPD Blue?
Yeah, NYPD Blue and Headline News. She's the Headline News anchor.
Right.
Oh,
she's the one
who
has to show her boobs on NYPD Blue.
Yeah. Right.
She is going to be Jack Bauer's new partner.
Ooh, right. Really?
Well, bring her on.
You know, those breasts deserve to be back on primetime TV.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hi. Yes. I wanted to tell you, I also read in TV Guide, the tattoo that you could see on Jack's arm when he was trying to shoot up.
Right. Yeah.
He didn't like the makeup, so he actually went out and got that tattoo put on his arm for the
Kiefer Sutherland
did? I believe that, yeah.
Kiefer Sutherland is nuts.
He is.
What's the tattoo?
Yes, he is nuts.
It's a giant, intricate tattoo that looks of oriental nature.
Uh-huh. Really?
And it goes all the way from his wrist all the way up to his elbow on the inside of his arm.
Previously on my tattoo.
I wouldn't doubt that. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hey, Don and Mike, what's going on?
Hey.
I just wanted to say, if they focused on the plot as much as they focused on Ford product placement, I think it'd be a much better show. It was ridiculous.
Well, so it was really that obvious, huh, that the Ford stuff was all over
the place? Yeah, every car.
You couldn't avoid it.
Every car had the bright logo.
I think maybe it was just, I think we'll see Ford vehicles throughout the season, but I think it was maybe heavier in this first commercial-free episode.
Yeah, I agree.
And I also believe in the first season he drove a Tahoe. I do think that, because I'm sensitive to Chevrolet product.
Rob and I are feeling the same thing right now, that, you know, if there are Ford products all over the show, you know, throw a Chevy in there.
No, I'm talking to a buddy of mine last night after the show is on, and that was my first complaint. I said, God, Were there enough Ford trucks?
Right.
How about a little more plot and a little less Ford trucks?
Yeah.
And then this guy that I know who works in media said, oh, you do, he said to me, I'm surprised for someone who thinks they know as much as you think you know that you don't know this. He said, have you noticed that on Fox, on the football show on Sunday, the James Brown, Terry Bradshaw
right.
show, that's the Ford F-150 pregame show. He said, Do you remember two or three weeks ago when they brought Kiefer Sutherland on for whatever dumb reason it was, and he was actually on the show talking about football, but he doesn't really know anything about football?
Right.
This guy explained to me, he said, it's all part of a gigantic advertising deal that Fox went and said, listen, we get you involved in our football. You sponsor the football.
Right.
Then the same people who watch football will watch 24, and you sponsor our football show when we put Kiefer Sutherland on, mm-hmm. and then on the first episode of 24, it's sponsored without commercials by Ford, but really, the whole show's a commercial for Ford.
Right. And subconsciously, they've been jamming Ford into our brains.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's how they do it.
And it works. We're talking about it.
And the guy, my friend, said to me,
I think General Motors would do that.
Guy said, I'm amazed that you're so dumb you didn't pick up on that. And I said, well,
that was cruel.
Okay.
You know who else is really guilty of product placement in a bad way is if you watch the last season of The Sopranos. Every television is a Philips television, but
you got to notice this,
the word Philips is bigger on the front of it than any other Philips television in real life. It's got like a supersized logo.
That's his brain. He's got that in there, ladies and gentlemen.
Probably right.
Don and Mike show. Hello.
Don and Mike, Rob's wrong now.
Why is Rob wrong?
Because Rob is gay.
Now, do you have anything to back that up, sir?
Just what I've seen on the internet.
Well, that proves it, then.
That's only partially true.
Rob. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Damn, I thought those pictures were gone.
Hello. Hi.
Yeah, I was wondering if you noticed that the tattoo that Kiefer had also was the same as some of the cartel people.
What?
The tattoo was similar to the cartel guys. It might have been. Who
didn't
knows?
Catch that.
But here's what I don't get about 24. They talk about how it's one of those shows that it's a critical success and people like it, but it's not really an over-the-top smash hit.
Mm-hmm.
How come we watch it and we come in and talk about it? And seriously, I'm looking at our phones. We could do this for an hour.
Yeah. Because everybody watched it.
Talk to people about 24.
It's right? on TV. Yeah.
But I bet it didn't win its time slot last night.
Well, I'll find out.
Would you, Buzz?
Yeah, I will.
I'd be rooting for it to win its time slot.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think so. One more call on this. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Howdy.
Hey, why do you guys like Kiefer Sutherland's little skank ho daughter on that show?
Hold on a second. You don't like Alicia Cuthbert?
This guy's gay.
Now listen,
every show I just pray that she'll get her throat slit and we'll be done with her. She is such an idiot.
Listen,
what's wrong with you?
There is room for debate among guys and girls, but listen,
there's certain women that you don't debate.
When you get a clean sweep among all four of us, me, Mike, Buzz, and Robbie, mm-hmm. when we all say she's a piece of ass.
She's a complete piece of ass. Yeah.
Then you got to go with it. And you have to just say, you're wrong. The problem is with you.
Yeah.
And why do you think she's stupid?
Because the last show I saw, I stopped watching 24 when she was locked inside of that mini-mart with the guy who was going to shoot her.
Mm-hmm.
And I just said, can she just die one of these times? How can somebody be in this many situations?
You're angry. You've got anger issues.
Do you think anybody's listening to the show right now, our show, and thinking that about you?
Yeah, they all hate me.
All right, I always like to get a little balanced perspective. Who do you consider, what public figure, celebrity, do you consider to be a hottie?
You stuck me on the spot now.
It's old women.
I like it when they talk like a 1930s movie.
Here they come. When who talks like a 1930s?
Meanwhile, they're always talking like that, darling. I've got to go there. That kind of.
I love that.
But name.
But that turns you on. You are gay.
But name.
Yeah.
Not that there's anything wrong with that.
Name a woman who you think is hot in today's society.
I like Angelina Jolie, except for that big lip.
You like who?
How can you say you like Angelina Jolie and then you say you don't like her lips?
Just the bottom lip. Too big.
I'd say Angelina. See,
what is your problem?
It's so subjective. Angelina Jolie is a skank compared to Jack Bauer's daughter.
But here's the deal. I mean, don't you have anybody that you just like?
Yeah, let's see.
You wouldn't change surgically?
Change it all.
Who?
I'm thinking. I'm pretty critical, huh?
Well, I'd just like to see if you're possibly able to come up with a name.
Have women been mean to you?
When is the last time your cold, clammy hand actually got close to a warm genital spot on a woman?
I just left my house and just got some.
So you're married?
Yeah.
And is there any... Who does your wife look like?
Kate Jackson from the Charlie Angels.
From the Charlie Angels.
Charlie's.
No, you said from the Charlie Angels.
My guess is right now his wife looks like Jake LaMotta in Rage on the Bull.
Oh, God, yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised.
It's self-inflicted. Wow. She has to live with him.
Yeah. Jesus.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Oh, man.
Hi.
Hi.
How you doing?
We're doing very well, thank you.
You know something? You guys are the radio gods, but all of you are wrong today.
About what?
Well, I've got to agree with that last guy. So I don't like Jack's daughter on that show.
This is now. I love it when we open a door, and I mean, I'm amazed at this. I really am.
Yeah.
I thought she was universally loved.
Mike,
by
it
men.
Seems to me, and I know it's an unscientific poll, and it's only been two calls, and who am I to know is first impression? But it just seems to me that the guys that don't think she's hot appear to be borderline retarded.
I believe so.
That they have very, very little social skills.
Yeah.
They're clumsy with the language. They don't know how to speak into the telephone.
Seems to be guys that are actually doing something foolish, like when Alicia Cuthbert is on screen, they're listening to her dialogue.
Right.
You're not supposed to do that.
Maybe that's what the problem is.
I don't care where she was on that show. Just let her run.
Well, you know something? The other guy had a little bit of trouble.
Sorry. It's the solar flares. We're losing this guy's call.
They're knocking that call off the air.
I'm very sorry. Sorry, I don't know if you can hear me or not.
Yes, I'm still here.
Yeah, well, can you hear? Can you hear? I tell you, guy in the commercial, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Solar Stein.
Can you? Oh, all right, here you go. And
let's see.
Oh, it's
hello?
Gone now.
It's gone now. Are you there?
Oh, no.
Well, he's gone.
Party time.
He's gone.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Anyway, we are just a little protective of the Hollywood starlets that we dream about.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, she's unique.
And I'll tell you why I think we feel so strongly about her. She's one that we all called years ago.
Absolutely.
I mean, when that show first came on the air, we came on the air and said, not only is 24 a good show, but Jack Bauer's daughter is just a grade-A piece of ass.
Jack Bauer. Was it a white, tank top, like a wife beater t-shirt she had on in that one episode? Remember that one?
Yeah. It was a white, faux gray thing.
Oh, my God.
Big nippleage, and
it was phenomenal.
Brushless.
Would she be great in the marshmallow races? Put a marshmallow between her pillows and let her go topless down our hallway.
And at the end of the race, watch the watch everybody on the show fight for that marshmallow.
Right. Would you eat the marshmallow next on 24? Previously, when Don, Mike, and Buzz and Rob fought over the marshmallow. We got a break, everybody. We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
My name is Larry Williams, and I sure would be interested in the movie.
You got a big d***, Larry?
Yeah, I got a d***. I got a d*** that long and that big around. I got a good d***. I got a d*** made of gold. I got a good d***. I got a lovely d***.
Johnny, what?
I got a beautiful d***. I got a lovely d***.
I'll keep it in mind.
And it can 24 hours a day. Around the clock. I got a d*** that go around the clock.
So the girls in this neighborhood are pretty happy. They're walking around with smiles in their faces.
Yeah. Hell, f*** yeah.
There ain't any girls around here with frowns.
Hell no. Because I am the damn Dickman. D-I-C-K-E-M-A-N. I am the Dickman.
All right.
Yeah, your world. I'm just like a squirrel trying to crack a nut. Yeah, buddy. Hey, take me to the movie.
All right.
Hey, Larry, we'll see ya. All right.
All right, thanks.
Bye-bye.
Take care, Larry.
Well,
bye-bye.
Well, thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
The Don and Mike Show. You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Oh, what a hoot, and so totally refreshing.
Yeah. All right.
Cleansing your ears with a verbal enema. Don and Mike.
The
know, I'm always on the fence about Rod Stewart. It's like, if a song like this is on, I listen to it, I like it. Last night, I was watching, he's done an album of standards now. Like The Way You Look Tonight, the Frank Sinatra song.
Just the way you look tonight.
And he does a duet with Cher, and he does a duet with somebody else, and it's just so freaking sickening anti-Rod Stewart, because he still has that same... You know how Mac Davis's face got all stretched out from the
right.
drinking and everything?
Exactly.
He's got that same leathery, leopardy skin,
right.
and he's still got the crazy hair.
Right.
But he's wearing a three-piece suit and a tie.
Yeah.
And he's in front of an orchestra going, just the way you look.
And it makes you mad.
Tonight. Yeah, it's like, why?
You know, I go back to with Rod Stewart. That song you just played was the moment. That's when he lost me. Right mm-hmm. after that, that's his last real rock and roll record.
Hot Legs, yeah.
Hot Legs was it. Right after Hot Legs, wasn't it Do You Think I'm Sexy? Wasn't that...
I think Do You Think I'm Sexy was before Hot Legs.
Oh, okay. Well, see, he lost me with Do You Think I'm Sexy.
I bet he lost you with You're In My Heart.
Yeah, yeah.
You're In My Soul.
And I go back, way back when. I was a Rod Stewart fan. I remember when the Eagles were booed off stage as an opening act for Rod Stewart.
Yeah.
And he was doing things like Stay With Me and Maggie May and that stuff.
You know,
and then, you know, he's one of those survivors, but it's very, you know, I hate to see anybody get it that watered down.
It's sad. Just, you know, do what the Eagles do. If you got to do what the Eagles do, mm-hmm. announce that you're breaking up. Then when you run out of money, 5 years later, come back and go, hey, we're coming back.
Uh-huh.
You know, this is really the fun. Or do what Cher is. How many goddamn farewell tours has Cher done?
Well, I bought Michael McDonald's new album, the one where he sings the Motown hits, and I really, I enjoyed it, and I felt like an old fart enjoying it. Because you know what? Every song on there really does sound like it's some sort of commercial for an investment banker.
And one of them is a commercial.
Yeah, yeah, they've made one of them into a game. But, I mean, they all have that sound. And I'm kind of liking it. I like his voice. I like what he is. He's got a unique voice.
Do you remember when we heard that on the radio in Iceland? Michael McDonald? Rob and I were driving around in the car, listening to the radio.
Of course.
We heard it.
And I heard it through the grapevine.
And I remember saying, have you ever heard this? And it turned out, there you go, Iceland miles ahead of us.
Yeah.
Michael McDonald.
Again.
Mike.
Did everything.
Here from Nielsen Ratings, here you go.
Okay.
Interesting, isn't it?
This is a tough one to mention after the discussion we had yesterday on the show. 24... The season premiere, the well-hyped premiere, did not win its time slot.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Don't tell me.
It was beaten in its time slot by, according to Jim.
No!
Yes.
No, it's a hit.
So you know what? We could have...
Oh, my God.
Oh, it's always been a hit. We could have spent the last 15 minutes on the show discussing the nuances of According to Jim. We would have had more people calling us.
Jesus.
Wow.
Right. And yesterday we spent a good amount of time discussing who's less funny than Jim Belushi.
And we only found one, Harry Anderson.
Harry Anderson.
That's God.
The only thing we found.
Oh, man.
All right. We got a letter here.
My God, that's sad.
From a very nice lady in Baltimore. Barbara McCary, and she listens on Live 105 in Baltimore.
Good.
And she sent a couple of items to us, news items. News of the weird.
I laugh about Baltimore because I don't know if you know it. We had there was a Marty Bass sighting last night.
Where?
I think maybe it was last night. I'm sure John Norman, our production guy, went to the Chris Rock concert.
Uh-huh.
And they had a Marty Bass. It's been, John, if you're listening to this, man, you got to tell Don what Marty Bass was wearing. It's too goddamn funny. What did you say? You saw him in the audience?
Just so everybody knows, Marty Bass is used to be a friend of ours. Now he's not because we goof on him on the
we
show.
We goofed on Marty Bass.
Marty Bass from Baltimore. He does the morning news on Channel 13 in Baltimore. He does the weather.
So we're sitting there, and we hear some guy behind us saying, "Hey, Marty." We start looking around, and I wouldn't know this guy if he came up and hit me in the head up until last night. And he sits down, and he's talking to some guy a couple seats over from my wife. She starts elbowing me in the side. She says, "That's Marty Bass. Marty Bass.
Marty Bass." And then you were very good at describing his outfit.
He's wearing a black pair of trousers, black suit jacket, and a sweater. and two diamond stud earrings.
Well, you got to, you know what you got to do? You got
40 bands.
You really, I'm sure they have a website. It's WJZ TV in Baltimore, Channel 13. You got to go and you got to look at a picture of the guy and then picture the outfit that Johnny was just describing. And then know that Marty Bass has the most Baltimore accent.
Absolutely.
That you could ever have here. I would be.
I'm Marty Bass.
You go down by the ocean, haunt with Marty Bass. Marty Bass.
And because we poke fun at him a lot, apparently when he bumps into people and our names come up, he gets a little violent.
He's not happy. But what pushed it over the edge with Marty Bass was when Lance Bass wanted to go into space.
Uh-huh. Right.
And we did that whole thing about how Marty Bass was related to
sure.
To
I'm Lance Bass, my cousin Marty.
Hey, Lance, you're an insane.
This is fantastic. Marty Bass and Lance Bass.
Listen, so this lady from Baltimore sends us this thing, and the first part that she wanted read on the show, I'll read it to you. It's cute, but it's one of those cute things we get all the time from people. In Aiken County, South Carolina, in May, a guy won a sheriff, the job of sheriff, and his name is Mike Hunt,
mm-hmm.
And she sent along a copy of his campaign slogan, Mike Hunt, accessible for you.
That's nice.
Okay, so that's a chuckle.
I like that.
Then there's something else she didn't mean. This is not highlighted on her page, but I read it, and this is now spotlight on Robbie. We need that, what is that, dun-dun-dun-dun, the fanfare thing? Spotlight on Sacramento.
Very exciting.
Spotlight on Sacramento.
Very good.
Big game there tonight with LeBron James against the Kings. And, oh, Christ, Jim Gray. You know, that little Jack Russell Terrier, we got to get him back on the
show. He's a pit bull.
Mm-hmm. Because last night I was watching ESPN, and, you know, we talked about this at the end of the show yesterday, the whole fight between Kobe and Shaq.
Right.
And Shaq saying, listen, you know, you shouldn't be coming out and playing until you get your legal problems settled. And then Shaq saying, well... Or Kobe saying, well, Shaq's just being a baby. He's always been a baby. Well, apparently Jim Gray called Kobe Bryant up on his cell phone and just out of the blue called him up because he had the number because he's interviewed him.
Right.
And said, hey, how would you like to talk about Shaq? And Kobe Bryant said, well, sure. And Jim Gray said, would you mind if I wrote down what you said? And Kobe Bryant said, no problem. And he said all this junk about Shaquille O'Neal. So last night when I got home and it was turned on to ESPN, it's Jim Gray standing in front of his house, in front of somebody. It wasn't Kobe Bryant's house.
Jim Gray is just such a nasty guy.
He's standing in front of just a house.
Right.
And he says, this is the phone. He's holding up the phone. This is the phone that I used to speak exclusively with Kobe Bryant earlier today. Now, I do not have a tape of my conversation with Kobe because it was a cell phone call.
Right.
It was a one-in-a-million call. And then he pulls out, you know, those reporter's notebook?
He had a reporter's notebook.
Right. He goes, and he actually, at one point, did the move that I love where he actually licks the end of the pencil.
Oh.
Now, right here, he says that Shaq is immature and childlike.
And he had a lot of dirt, obviously.
Yeah.
Now, is Kobe denying?
There was Kobe is not denying anything. He's not allowed to speak on the matter of the rape or anything else. But what he did say was Shaq is a big baby and Shaq is childish and needs to mind his own business.
And this is Jim Gray, who we had dinner with in New Orleans. Also, we should remind him about that.
Right, nutty Jim Gray.
He's crazy.
So here's a basketball note because the Kings are on TV tonight everywhere playing LeBron James. I'm surprised if this is true that this never worked its way back to us. This is from July. Now, according to a wrongful firing lawsuit filed in June by a former media relations assistant for the Sacramento Kings. Okay, so a lady got fired from the Sacramento Kings. She was a media relations assistant.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, star player Doug Christie of your Sacramento Kings is not permitted to speak to any female other than his wife for any reason.
Wow.
This, according to Mrs. Christie, is the Christie family policy.
Wow.
Now we're going to need some calls here to find out if this is... Remember, I think I said...
All right, repeat it again. What is it exactly?
The most pussy-whipped guy in the world.
Yeah.
And now I'll read you the whole thing. According to a wrongful firing lawsuit filed in June by a former media relations assistant to the Sacramento Kings, star player Doug Christie is not permitted to speak to any female other than his wife for any reason.
Wow.
The assistant said she was fired because she innocently passed along a telephone message to Mr. Christie in the course of her work, but when Mrs. Christie found out, she pressured the organization to fire the media relations woman and reaffirm the well-known Christie family policy that Doug Christie is not allowed to speak to any female other than his wife for any reason.
That is absolutely the most amazing thing I've ever heard.
Yeah. Is that true?
And if it is, this guy's got problems.
Yeah.
She's got problems.
How could this have possibly gotten past our radar? I know. All right, Sacramento has to be calling now. Is this true? Are you from Sacramento?
Yes, I am.
Is this true?
Yes, it is. And I actually can send you an article from May of last year.
How come none of you guys called us to tell us this?
That wasn't made that big of a deal of, but after the playoffs ended last year, in May, there was an article that came out in the New York Times that you are not going to believe. And that was done in New York, and that was never brought out really in Sacramento. But we all pretty much know it.
What is
so what was the gist of the article was the same thing that we were talking about?
It's called The Christies Are Keeping Temptation on the Ropes, and it talks about how they get married every year. Full-on wedding
with
a reception and a wedding cake and you name it.
Spotlight on Pussy Whipped in Sacramento.
Could we have found perhaps the most pussy whipped man in America?
Yeah. Has to be.
Yeah.
I was saying, you should read this article, though. It's unbelievable.
Thank you. Listen, hold on. You know what? You get a prize, because that's good information.
That is excellent information.
Everybody is calling with that, but here you go. You were the first to get through. You're a lady, and you want a lady's leather fossil watch.
Cool.
Courtesy of Fox, season premiere of True Calling, tomorrow night at 8, 7 Central on Fox. Have you ever thought if I could just do that day over again, would I do it differently and change the outcome? Well, I bet Doug Christie is thinking this.
Oh,
when he agreed to this deal with his wife.
Yeah, or maybe she's got him on some kind of medication.
All right, thank you. Hold on a second.
Okay.
Enjoy your prize in the constant contest.
That's amazing.
So I'm reading this. The lady from
get married every year. You guys both want to do that, don't you? Get married every year and have a wedding cake and everything?
No. Remember, my plan was that you worked on like the 5 to 7 year plan, and once you got past the 5 to 7, you're locked in. There's no getting out. You're stuck.
Sure. I never made it to that.
You're stuck, and I just want to hold on to this. The next time some guy calls up and listen, I'd be the first to admit it. I'm pussy whipped. My wife runs the house. I'm happy with it the way that it is. But anybody wants to bust my balls, I'm gonna say, hey, at least I'm not as bad as star player Doug Christie.
Any relation to Jeff Christie?
Who is not a cabbage.
Rush Limbaugh's old DJ name.
Cabbage,
right?
Lots of cabbage.
For anyone that wanted to know.
Well, now here, I'm guessing all these calls are from Sacramento.
It's amazing, though. Not allowed to speak to a woman. If this can't be a good marriage. This can be a marriage with no trust.
Hello? Right. Yeah, you calling from Sacramento? You must be. Don and Mike show. Hello?
Sunspots.
All right, well, Buzz, you know what? Maybe you're right.
Yeah.
Maybe it's the sunspot. No, it's just hi, Robbie.
You know, I don't follow the sport, but is this guy so drop-dead gorgeous that if he talks to a woman,
she'll immediately sleep with him?
Yeah. I think, hi, Don and Mike show. Hello.
Hey, Don.
Hey.
Hey, I was really surprised you guys were just out talking about this, but...
We're really surprised you didn't call and tell us.
Well, I'm not really a Kings fan, but it was quite interesting the way the Maloofs put a spin on the whole story.
Now, these are the guys that own the team, right?
Correct.
Right.
After she got fired and all this came out about the wife, the Maloofs spun it to where, oh, no, this girl was derelict in her duties, and we were going to end up letting her go anyway. And I was like, get out of here.
This guy's wife, this guy's a Christie.
All right, and I'm going to lay odds.
She has to be the supreme C, though.
Well, I'm going to...
Oh, she is.
And I'm going to... Have you seen a picture of the lady that was fired? She's got to be hot, right?
She's not bad.
Okay,
but,
see?
I mean,
and what does Doug Christie's wife look like?
She's all right, but as soon as you her personality is like, I would look the other way.
And I follow Bazzi. He's like, just say this. I don't want to sound.
Was he an average-looking guy? He's no Vladdy Divac.
Okay.
There you go. He's no Kevin McHale.
No,
I go back a ways. You have to go back a few years and get retired players when you're looking for the ugliest NBA players.
Hello, Dan.
Yeah.
Hey. Yeah, Don and Mike. Hey.
Hey, how you guys doing?
We're doing very well.
Oh, yeah, man. Christy, if you watch any Sacramento King game, after every foul shot, after every shot he makes, he makes this little signal up in the air, and it's a signal to let his wife know that he's thinking of her and that he loves her. And he's supposed to do this. He doesn't, and she'll...
And then, how could you not have...
Wow.
Listen, now, here's where I'll cut you some slack. We're not on in St. Louis, so it was not really news that we had to bring to you that
right.
Kurt Warner is pussy-whipped and that his wife has a radio show, and his wife says all kinds of junk like, well, if Kurt Warner doesn't get back in the starting lineup, we want to be traded and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But because it's not relevant because we're not on in St. Louis.
Right. But Sacramento's a different story.
We're on in Sacramento. We're number one in Sacramento, and you guys mean to tell me this is... I have to find out from somebody in Baltimore that this guy's so pussy-whipped in Sacramento? Oh, but it's great to finally know.
It's, yeah. It's an amazing, and it seems to be getting better and better with that. You know.
Now I'm going to watch the game tonight.
Or a man.
I was going to watch the game tonight anyway.
See the guy running up and down the court in a dress?
watch and see him.
Wow.
That is, I mean, here's the, is his wife annoying like that Brenda Warner hag is, Kurt Warner's wife, where she sits in the front row with her spiked hair?
Here's my stereotypical thinking right here. I would picture the... You know, think Texas beauty queen, former Texas beauty queen type. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Where it's the thank you. Think Phyllis George type. That's right. What I'm thinking about. I really am.
I bet she's not that hot.
Well, I bet she's like, she's probably like a Miss America that won but was lucky because there were other sexier women in it.
Formerly pretty. Yeah.
He must have done something. Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
usually to be punished like that.
Maybe he was like boning one of the ball girls or something.
But if they're it would seem to me if they're making such a big deal about this, demonstrating this love for one another and not talking to other women, there would be, I mean, that's a leaky ship. He doth protest too much category.
Wouldn't it be funny to call the Sacramento Kings just on the business line and go, hello, can I speak to Doug Christie? Hey, is Doug there? We had a wonderful night last night. Hello. Tell him thank you for dinner. Don and Mike show. Hello.
Hey, Don, Mike.
Hey.
Last year when Fox and Doug Christie got into their fight, if you watch the videotape as they go into the tunnel, you see Doug Christie's wife following, getting ready to go pound on Fox.
Fox who? Who's
no, Rick Fox. Now that would be a fight I'd want to see. That was Vanessa Williams versus Doug Christie's wife.
Well, I'm taking Vanessa Williams. I'm taking Vanessa Williams on any level.
Now that's the fight that they should have. So she ran after Rick Fox.
Yeah, after Rick Fox and Doug Christie got in the fight on the court, Fox ran around the arena, was going to meet Christie in the tunnel. And you see them getting into it, and then you see Doug Christie's wife following after.
All right, hold on. We got a story now. And Robbie, I think we'll need the Globetrotters music for this. Here we go. We got the whole story here.
Wow. Very good.
You know what? We got to do a break first.
This is pay dirt right here.
We got to do a break first. And for those of you listening to us in Sacramento, Guy, I'm really like 2 months old, but we just heard about it.
We're having fun with this. Yeah. Bear with us. Absolutely.
To us, it's news. We got the entire story here. Pro basketball. Headline. The Christies are keeping temptation on the ropes.
That's great.
Jesus Christ. Okay, and hold on. This has got, as I'm just glancing at this, her name is Jackie. he does do the hand signals to her during the game. Doug Christie says he's a willing participant in these rituals.
Oh, dear. Oh, dear.
Well, he has to say
sustaining that. Sustaining relationships can be difficult for NBA players. Oh, this, you know what? This is a whole break. We need this story. This is a whole break. What a pussy whipped guy.
Wow.
I got him. I got to just make a quick
you
call.
You got to. Are you feeling good?
Say,
are you feeling good right now?
I'm not on the bubble anymore. I'm not the most pussy whipped guy in the world.
Right.
My wife lets me talk to other girls. No, Shondell was in here. I'm going to go to Shondell's party with my wife.
You're like a free man.
Shondell's orgy party on Friday night.
It's amazing.
Saturday night.
In any work environment, that would be almost impossible if you had that rule that you couldn't talk to women.
Well, where are you, darling? Well, if I have to, I'll leave the message. That's how pussy whipped I am. I don't dare just hang up because she'll call back and say, did you call?
Don't forget.
Make sure she knows.
Don't forget the signal.
Listen, one of my wife's got a real butch message on her machine. She's got one that goes, "Hi, this is Frida. Leave a message if you like. Hello, Linda." And I'm not getting anything.
Unexpected. Maybe you dialed the wrong number.
Maybe so. Or maybe it's the spots.
Sunspots. Sun. Well, it's the solar storm.
Yeah. Yeah, well. See, this is how pussy whipped I am. I'm so pussy whipped.
Hi, sweetie.
Hi, baby. I'm dying to. Oh, are you doing your thing now?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry about that. My
wife. That's all right.
I just wanted to take a second out to tell you.
Yeah.
You're going to love this.
Yeah.
I am officially not the most pussy whipped guy in the world. I'm off the bubble. Listen to this, baby.
All right.
There's a guy who plays basketball in Sacramento for the Kings. He's a star player named Doug Christie. He and his wife have a rule that, and I guess he's done something before. We're not really
sure.
We have the story here. We're going to read it in a second. They have a family policy that he is not allowed to speak to any female other than his wife. Speak. For any reason, there is a woman who worked for the Sacramento Kings, a media relations assistant. She innocently passed along a telephone message to Doug Christie in the course of her work, and when Mrs. Christie found out that he had spoken to this woman who gave him a telephone message, she pressured the organization to fire her and reaffirm the Christie family policy. And now the woman is suing the Sacramento Kings. But it's just great to know that I'm not the last guy. And I can now look down on somebody and say, "Ha ha! Hey, Doug Christie, how you doing?"
So he's feeling the love for you right now, Frida.
Well, that's good. Well, you can speak. You just can't touch. I mean, maybe can he touch?
No, he can't. He can't. And we had and Shondell was in here earlier. We're going to her party on Saturday, and you know, we talked to Shondell, and look at that.
Absolutely.
Look at that. You don't have a rule that I can't talk to other women.
No talking.
You know, and I didn't even get mad when you didn't think I was listening, and you said that you would just lob me on Marcia, and then you would, you know, be free.
Well, be free with Buzz.
Yeah. So that Don and I can talk.
Right.
Well, you can't talk to other men.
All right, baby. Anyway, it's. I just had to say, it's great to know that I'm not the most.
Well, very good. I'm happy for you, my darling.
Thank you, darling.
All right, bye, sweetie.
Bye. Thank you for chatting with me.
Okay, you're welcome.
Love
you. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.
Here she is.
You know what that means,
that
bro?
That ended wonderfully.
You're moving up the list, too.
Everybody moves up a spot.
Everybody moves up a spot.
Yeah, that's right.
Fantastic. All right, well, we're loaded with calls about this.
Can't wait to hear more about this.
We're loaded with all kinds of calls. I'm looking at Joe screening these calls. That, you know, I don't know if we can take these calls. We live in a very litigious society, and I don't know if we can take the calls with some of the things that people are
alleging
that this basketball player may have done.
To change things.
Or may not have done. But either way, we have the story, I believe, Sports Desk. What paper is this from? And what paper is this from?
From the New York Times.
Story from the New York Times.
Aforementioned. Serious journalism.
Right, because they don't make stuff up in the New York Times. We'll be right back, everybody.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Yeah, well, first of all, I want to address something. I hear ESPN is trying to f*** me, and you guys are trying to make a controversy. There's not going to be a controversy. I was joking around with one of my friends, and that's it. If you don't like it, you and your families too. Now let's talk about the game.
The Don and Mike Show. They're more soothing than a pair of buttery soft moccasins. Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
I don't know if you missed it at the beginning of the show today. You know, Friday is Halloween.
Halloween.
And Joe Ardinger will be out doing his trick or beer thing again.
Yeah, brings a beer cooler and says trick or treat for beer.
Yay. Also on Friday, the return of the marshmallow races. You get a chance to race down our hallway with a marshmallow in between two pillows.
Very exciting.
And we'll give it away $1,000, and girls get an extra 5 seconds worth of time if they do the race topless.
Yes, I think it's the only way to make the competition fair.
Mm-hmm. 12 years between running that bit.
This is fantastic. I remind everyone, really, if you've ever enjoyed a show, you will enjoy this one.
Hey, Buzz.
Yes.
Buzz, here we go, right here. Right. There you go. Buzz and I share a love of this song.
It's a good song.
And you never heard this version by U2. You never freaking hear it.
Great.
All right, let's do the Robbie, load the sports stuff in there. Because we're going to read this article about Doug Christie.
Oh, hold on. Not ready for it yet. Hold on.
Oh,
just a second. Because we got not only the article we have from Sacramento Magazine, an article about his wife, the woman behind the man.
Ah. Wow.
So we got a lot of ground to cover here.
Very close
behind.
Let's
start with the New York Times story. Let me see. Oh, the Christies. Here we go. If I could just take a moment. Speaking of sports.
Spies.
Speaking of sports. I'll just give them a plug. The Junkies. They used to be known as the Sports Junkies.
Right.
Now they're just the Junkies. They work on another station here in D.C. on HFS. Another POS station owned by Infinity. I was in the car today and heard those guys. And I really like the way they sound. They sound great. And we get calls, sometimes back in the office. They say, we wish the Junkies were still on. And I don't know. I don't ever talk to those. I talked to Lurch maybe about 4 months ago, just out of the blue one day. He just called and said, hey, how you doing? So, I guess this is the only way that I'm going to communicate with them because it's awkward. They used to work here. Anyway, I'd say good show.
And good luck, guys. Yeah. Keep up the good work.
Good job. Sports made me just think of that. And Every once in a while, someone says to me, guy, we really used to like it when, you guys would be on and the Junkies would come on your show.
Absolutely.
Anyway, so.
Good guys.
There you go. What the hell. Pro basketball. The Christies are keeping temptation on the ropes. Sacramento. In the final minute of an NBA playoff game, Doug Christie raised his left fist, extending his pinky and index fingers towards the rafters of Arco Arena. Christie, a lanky swingman for the Sacramento Kings, appeared to be calling out a play for his teammates. But it was actually a message for his wife, Jackie, seated in the stands.
Very good.
He often makes the same hand signal at least 50, that's 50 times a game.
Wow. Well, I'm glad he's focused on the game.
It's just a signal to let my wife know I love her and she and my family are bigger than basketball. Christie said. Jackie Christie said she and her husband began communicating with each other during games a while ago. When I make this sign, it means drive to the hole, she said.
So now she's giving him plays?
When I make this sign, it means smile because you look a little sad on the bench. He started making this sign and said, this means I love you.
Oh, my God. Come on.
Developed from there. It makes me feel real special.
Wow.
A little background here while we're reading this. There's a rule of the Christie family, Doug Christie, the basketball player. He's not allowed to talk to any female. He's not allowed to speak to any female other than his wife. Apparently, there was a woman who worked for the Sacramento Kings in the office staff. She told this guy he had a telephone message. This guy's wife found out about it. And she had the Sacramento Kings fire the woman who gave him the message.
This is very weird. It's frightening.
Reporters who cover Christie's former team, the Toronto Raptors, were so intrigued by the couple's sign language, they created a betting pool when the Raptors played at Sacramento last year. During that game, he signaled his wife 62 times during the game.
You know, I really would think, and take all of the pussy whip factor out of it, That would seem to be somewhat of a distraction when you're playing.
If you were another guy on that team, wouldn't you say to him at some point, hey, dude,
chill out.
Let's focus on scoring points. Stop waving at your bitch wife.
I'd have a sign for him.
Was really what he's doing. He's waving at her.
Yeah.
Now, hold on. They counted 62 times, and then they went to her after the game. And here is a quote from Jackie Christie. Quote, 62, Jackie said, shaking her head in a pleased manner.
Like counting?
Yes, as she clutched her husband's hand on the couch at their home in suburban Sacramento. Ooh. 62. That's beautiful. When the Kings flew to Los Angeles for Game 3 of the Western Conference Finals against the Lakers, Jackie was seated next to Doug, as much a part of the postseason experience as any family member in the NBA.
Now, flew on the team plane?
I don't, Mike, I'm just reading it.
Sounds like she flew on the team plane.
Let me see. In the frantic world of pro sports, athletes have trouble balancing their personal and public lives. The perception of don't ask, don't tell marriages is sometimes a reality. The Christies have gone to great lengths to make sure that their own vows are sacred. With few exceptions, Doug Christie does not look at other women. He avoids dialogue with other women and avoids eye contact with other women.
Jesus.
God damn, is he pussy whip.
Yeah.
This is something.
And this is coming from me, okay? Okay, understand.
I understand.
This is from me. I'm there, but he's worse. Quote from Doug Christie. Every conversation I've ever had with a woman since I've been married, besides my wife, she knows about. She's been there. But what are we talking about? Banking? Mortgage? Other than that, I don't have anything to say to any women. It's taking up my time, and my time is limited to basketball, my family, and my wife.
Please.
The Christies, who have been married for 8 years and have 3 children, get married on July 8th each year, their anniversary. It's not a mere renewing of their wedding vows. It's an actual wedding.
Wow.
Replete with family, friends, cake, and a reception. This year, they'll be married on the foundation of their new, not-yet-completed home in Bellevue, Washington. His agent, who is also a minister, has married them the last 2 years.
Stay cool, guys.
The agent, Bradley Marshall. Hold on.
Oh, there you go. You know what? I know why. This is getting you choked up,
sure.
Is what it's doing.
I feel bad for this guy.
Yeah. I'm fascinated, and I would love to. You know, it's interesting hearing you read the article.
We'll never get his side.
I'd just love to see his face. You know, I'd like to see them interviewed together and just see his face. I would imagine that he looks like somebody who's maybe in, like, a controlled coma.
Watch the game tonight.
Okay.
The game is on TNT, or right. On ESPN now. They're on ESPN.
Oh, I'm now a fan.
It's the late game. It's the 10:30 game, and it's LeBron James in Cleveland, so it's a big game. Let me see. Okay, here's a quote from his agent, who is also a minister. At first, I thought it was a little bit much, but when you see the dividends it pays, you understand. They invite other married couples to the wedding, and they're encouraged by the whole process. Jackie attends 30 of the Kings' 41 regular season road games, and to answer your question...
Road games!
And Mike, to answer your question, she rides on the team's charter plane. Now, you tell me that's not going to piss off the other boys.
Oh, you bet your ass it is.
Price doesn't fly it.
Not that the other boys are up there getting their knobs polished.
No, that doesn't happen on a team plane.
It is a boys' environment.
Right.
I mean, you know what I mean.
No, it's a locker room.
There might be a waitress on the plane.
You never know.
Who knows? Let me see. Here she is again, a quote from her. I used to tell people I was married to an athlete and they would give me that look. Oh, well, you know what he's doing. And she says, I don't explain anymore.
This is an insecure woman.
Yeah, he's different. I travel with him, and he's not like the rest. I just know Doug is faithful.
Yeah,
well, listen, hello, C-word, hello, bitch. Listen, if you really knew that your husband was faithful, you wouldn't follow him around everywhere he goes.
Exactly.
When Christie played for the Raptors, his wife once confronted a female fan seeking an autograph.
Oh, boy.
A security guard grabbed her, but I put my hand up and told her to back off really loud. It scared me because my voice sounded like a demon that just came out. She was a pretty girl. She was very young. But she was touching my husband on the hand.
Oh, boy.
She was touching someone she shouldn't have been.
Wow, this is getting better and better.
Let me see.
My goodness.
Some wives of pro athletes focus on the perks of life in the big time. Affluence, public attention. Jackie Christie sees it differently. She sees a world in which her husband and other players are battling the seduction of women who wait after games and prowl hotel lobbies. You see so much of that going on, she said, and you think, is that going to happen to me? I'm fine now. I gave up trying to change things.
She was going to try to change things for everybody?
Yeah. I gave up trying to change things. People are going to be the way they're going to be. Now my attitude is, whatever we have to do to keep our circle tight, we're going to do it. Just respect what we have. Sustaining relationships can be difficult for NBA players, blah, blah, blah. Then it goes on, Rick Fox, who I mentioned he is married to Vanessa Williams. Jackie Christie arrives before games with her husband and leaves with him after. She sends him a note in the locker room before every game, taken there by a team attendant.
My God, I cannot believe this.
Wait, it gets worse.
Wow.
It gets worse. So she sends a note to the locker room. He writes a reply and sends it back.
You know, that's really nice that they're taking
staff members
on the team to do this crap.
Think about if you're one of the other guys on the team.
Yeah.
And you're in the locker room, you're getting your head together.
Well, you got to look the other way. I mean, you got to complain, because otherwise, you know, you go
they gotta, if he's waving to her 62 times during a game,
right.
And if they're sending notes, these other guys have to say, faggot. We got to play a game tonight. What are you doing sending a note to your wife?
I really would imagine it would be somewhat of a distraction.
Let me see. Jackie Christie arrives before games with her husband. He writes the reply. Sometimes on the road, Jackie will ride in a car behind the team bus.
That's them. That's when he's making his cell phone calls.
Hold on. No. She is so far ahead of you. You're going to love this. Jackie will ride in a car behind the team bus on the road, talking to Doug on his cell phone until he arrives at the hotel or arena. So it's like if she can't watch him every second, she's driving in a car behind the team bus and talking to him on the
telephone. This is borderline mentally ill here.
Yeah, it's a little psycho.
Doug Christie says he is a willing participant.
Right.
Okay, well, what else can he say?
All hostages say that.
That's right.
Quote, it was hard for me to do the interview about this and say this is my life because people will say that's garbage. He's lying. But this is what I am and who we are. During Christie's time,
I don't think he's lying.
During Christie's time in Toronto, Jackie was uncomfortable that women who worked for the Toronto Raptors went into the locker room to distribute statistics after the game. So Doug began dressing in a room by himself.
Oh, my God!
An Eastern Conference team official speaking on under the condition of anonymity said that he had warned the Kings about obtaining Doug Christie 2 years ago because of the issues with his wife.
Oh. So do you think that's why the Raptors got rid of him?
Hold on. Here's Jackie. I just feel a need, quote, I just feel a need to protect my territory. I have a lot of issues. I have a jealous bone in my body, yes. It's probably as big as me. I'm easygoing until I feel a threat.
Shut up.
She says Doug is allowed to look at females. I would prefer he did not.
Oh, my God.
Hold on.
That article, that was worth it.
Hold on, and I'm not done with you. I was just going to say, if ever there was a time to be able to say the C word on the radio.
C.
This would be it.
My goodness.
Hold on a second. Jackie sometimes has made it clear to her husband and team employees that certain female reporters will not be allowed to interview her husband unless she is present.
Oh, wow. God.
If a certain... no. These are all quotes now. And do you think this applies to Jim Nance?
No.
Here's another quote from his wife.
This is really amazing.
From his wife. If a certain female reporter wants an interview, I will attend it with my husband so there can be no games. Some of the Kings kid Christie about the hand signals.
No.
Let me see. Turkolo. I mean, the Kings have got all these guys like from Poland on their team. I don't know the name. Some of the Kings kid him. Let me see. The guy says a player on the team says that he flashes the sign at the guy's wife on the bench as well.
Now there you go. Good. All right. Good.
They have fun with it, but they also respect and accept it.
Right? Yeah, well, I'd sure like to talk to him. I'd like to talk to him behind closed doors.
Let me see. He met his wife at a sports bar through a friend before he was drafted out of Pepperdine in 92. His lifestyle, according to him, was much more carefree and rambunctious before marriage. Each of us has to go through and find our own way in time, and mine was the route I took. We all have choices, and the choices I was making back then were not the ones I would want to teach to my children.
Oh, boy.
Asked if he considered his current behavior drastic, he says no. Right. It's not that I'm not allowed to look at women.
I have been brainwashed.
It's not that I'm not allowed to look at women. It's just respect. I choose this.
Dear.
There's nothing out there for me to want to try to go after.
Now, we point out that he's saying it's not that he's not allowed to look, but he can't talk to them.
Right.
Without prior approval.
That's not what I'm trying to be about.
He's a prisoner.
Yeah. The Christies say their behavior has not been influenced by religious, sex, or life-altering events.
You know, I hate to say this, especially in the world climate. I don't think there's a religious sect that nuts.
Now, here is a quote from him. I can't explain it to you, except one way, or, you know, it just says Christy, so I don't know if it's him or her. I can't explain it to you, except one day we were in the driveway of our Seattle home before I got married, and all of a sudden, these revelations started coming to me in 1994. Christy said, it came from God. I used to tell her, I know where I want to go, but I don't know how to get there. This must be him talking.
Mm-hmm.
Everything became clear when I told her I wanted to marry her. Jackie looked approvingly at her husband and smiled. I get a lot of women who ask me, how do you get Doug to act this way? He said, our love is boundless and free. For me, it's not a restriction. It's a lifestyle, the way we live.
A lifestyle.
You pussy!
Like having stomach bypass surgery.
You incredible pussy!
Is that a picture of her that you have up there?
Yes, Mike. She has a website that is currently under construction.
Uh-huh.
It says, hi, thanks for coming. We're under construction. I guess it's JackieChristy.com. Coming soon, and she has a clothing line, The Unique Creations of Jackie Christie.
Yeah, there you go.
And right. Take a look, and I just want to say, this wouldn't be worth cutting off your balls for.
Wow.
I don't think.
She's not unattractive.
But I don't
but
think.
But she looks evil.
But I don't think that she's worth sacrificing, you know, looking at another woman, you know,
right.
just to say hello to.
She looks a little like Johnny Mathis.
I think she'd take out his eyes if he didn't need them to earn their income.
Yeah, right. I got one more for you here. She's the woman behind the man, Jackie Christie. Even though critics would like you to believe otherwise, Jackie Christie, 35, wife of Sacramento Kings star Doug Christie, knows the benefit her husband receives from her presence at his games. If he didn't want me there, I wouldn't be there, she said.
Right.
My husband has never made me feel uncomfortable about being with him at the games. He's always said, as long as you want to be at my side, you're my wife, you're my queen. I picked you, and I want you right there. Whatever the world thinks, let them think it.
Okay.
As with yin and yang.
Okay, we will.
As with yin and yang, she's my yang that makes my life come together. Christy says that her presence gives him a constant reminder of what is really important. And you got to know that.
Freedom.
That's
a good answer.
True.
That's what she wants to hear.
That's true. She attends more road games than any of the other Kings wives in team history and has not missed a home game since the birth of their son 2 years ago. Let me see. It's other people's opinion. He's supposed to get on a plane, fly.
I'm sure that helps her fit into the Mother of the Year category, too.
It's other people's opinion that he's supposed to get on a plane, fly away, come back a week later, and his family's supposed to just be sitting there waiting for him. Christy often surprises him on the road with herself and the children. Imagine that. Now, let's just say the guy's not even doing anything, but say he's working his man, that he's watching Spectrovision or something. And all of a sudden you get that...
Knock, 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 knock.
Hello?
Daddy! Daddy, we're here in Boston! Let me see. Then we got the stuff about renewing the vows. Doug is assisting Jackie with her new business venture, the clothing line. And they are writing a book together about their relationships and tips for others. They like being together. So that's the story.
Wow, wow, wow. You know, nothing like togetherness, but man, oh man, what the hell is going on here?
Unheard of.
Focus on Sacramento. We are going to talk about this when we come back. Hello, Don and Mike show. But this is a go-to call, I believe.
Hello.
Dan.
Yes.
Dan, spotlight on.
Doug Christie.
You're Sacramento Kings, Sacramento, California. All right, what do you got?
A couple of years ago when they had that last baby, during delivery, she was freaking out because there were female nurses in there, and Doug was actually thanking them for helping. And she freaked out. Don't look at my husband. Don't look at my husband. She was just insane. She wasn't really worried about the kid. The nurse is looking at him.
How do you people in Sacramento keep this stuff under the radar?
Grant Napier. He's in charge of it all. No, they just, you know, they hush it all up.
Yeah.
So, but yeah.
Well, it ain't hushed up now, and I guarantee
you. I'd like to really, have there ever been any other teammates that have talked,
I'd like to
you know,
invite,
on the record or, you know, off the record?
I would like to invite this bitch to come on our show, and she can, and just debate us on why it is that she feels the need to follow and monitor her husband's every freaking step.
Yeah, because, she's a C. She's crazy.
Because it really doesn't sound at all like support. It sounds like watching, you know, policing
captivity.
Really. Oh, yeah. And in Sacramento, it's such a small town, that's the only thing we got. So the reporters and everybody, you know, they
yeah, that's true. That's, if you talk Sacramento, the first thing you think is the Sacramento Kings. But
how do you think out in Sacramento, do you think that the media out there has been low-keying this?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Well, that's all we got. It's not like, you know,
but don't you have shock jocks, though? Don't you have anybody that would say, what an incredibly pussy-whipped man, and I use that word very loosely, he is?
No, the radio, Jesus Christ, the radio out here is horrible. You guys are the only thing worth listening to.
This is an amazing story, really, yeah. Because I've never heard anything quite like this in you know, in sports circles, no. And probably any circle.
Let me just, we got a break. I'm going to steal Mike's line, though, here. Let me go on record with this and say, even I would not stand for that.
Good for you, Don.
Way to go, Don.
Even I.
Way to make a fist.
Even I would not stand for that.
Right.
I want to tell you right now, I'm doing the show today.
Frida's in the lobby. She's surprising you.
And, oh, we got a break.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
So what is a wedding? Well, Webster's Dictionary describes a wedding as the process of removing weeds from one's garden.
The Don and Mike Show.
Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba, darling. The Don and Mike Show.
I got another question. If I'm watching the game tonight about this guy, the pussy whip guy.
Yeah.
If I watch the game tonight, will they show him on TV making the...
Yeah. I mean, if he does it 60 times...
Making the okie-dokie to his wife?
I would assume if he does it 50 times, 60 times during a game, you're going to see him do that.
No doubt.
What a pussy! Really? What a major pussy!
Well, as you said before in the question, I'd love to have answered, is there a pass there? And it sounds in that article like maybe there was a pass there.
Yeah, well, all right. Well, let's dive into these calls and see if anybody can tell us why it is that he's being led around by his pubes.
Yeah.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Don and Mike.
Yeah.
Hey, man. Calling from Sacramento. I got one more thing for you to look tonight at the game.
Yeah.
Check the tattoos on his arm, his upper arm. I'm not sure which side, but they're portraits of his wife and children. And that's no kidding.
Well, I think other guys have done that.
All right. We'll cut him slack on that one. Hello, Don and Mike Show. We'll just cut him a little slack.
Just a little bit.
And also a tattoo of his prisoner number.
Don and Mike, hello.
Hi, Mike. How are you doing?
We're doing great, thank you.
Oh, good. Hey, yeah, you'll see it. Every time he comes on and off the court, every time he makes a shot, gets a foul, whatever, he does his little signal for the wife.
All right, so we'll be able to catch it tonight on TV, right?
Oh, you can't miss it.
Now, do they ever go to a shot of the old bitch in the stands?
No. You won't see her. He points at the sky like she's God. But anyway, it's out there because I guess that after Doug Christie put the bitch slap on Rick Fox last year, Shaq came out and he made some comment about Christie's wife. I can't remember what it was, though, so maybe somebody else.
Rick Fox did? Oh, who can blame
Shaq? It's that Shaq did.
Shaq. Hey, my man!
Yeah. Shaq, who really has
my
comments
man.
About everything, you know?
So who knows? I mean, you can imagine that the wrath that she wanted to put on
Listen,
his
I'm sure that,
after that.
I'm sure that Shaquille O'Neal was only saying to the media what players around the league have been saying behind this guy's back. And who knows, maybe even, have you ever considered this? It's a tight game.
Right.
You know, one of those, you know, you watch the last 2 minutes of a basketball game, Kings down by one, they're bringing the ball up the court, and you see the guys jawing at each other, and it's always like, you know, oh, come on, you don't got what to say. What if he goes, you know, your wife is such a C.
Yeah, and you know what the thing is?
You're so pussy whipped.
Well, what does anybody know what caused the fight with Fox? You know? I mean, who knows what precipitated that altercation?
Yeah.
Perhaps there was a comment made, especially the whole league knows about it.
And why is she leading him around by his genitals? Why is he having to wave to her? And
it would seem to me that if you were in a tight game, it would be a tremendously easy thing to get into his head.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're playing for another team, you know, I think of the movie Slapshot, you know, where the guy skates around the goalie and says, "Your wife's a dyke."
Yeah, you know, and they're talking about Kobe Bryant being harassed at arenas with people yelling stuff at him.
Mm-hmm.
How come no one is yelling stuff at this?
Well, this seems to be under the radar.
And imagine you're on the bus. Mm-hmm. You're on the bus from the hotel to go to the arena for an out-of-town game, and you look behind you.
Right.
And she's driving in the rental car, and he's talking to her on the phone the whole time. Like, how long till you get to the hotel? I don't know. I'm not really doing the driving. Well, I think it's coming up in the next 4 or 5 minutes. I sure do love you. I sure do love you, too.
I think we're almost at the exit. Honey, I have to get up. It'll be 15 seconds between getting off the phone and getting off the bus.
Hello, Don and Mike show. God, yeah. World-class pussy.
Oh, yeah.
Really, and I'm sure she's not. He's a world-class pussy, and I'm sure she's not. I'm sure he's had better lays.
You never know. Maybe not. You don't know.
Well, if that's the case.
I mean, I agree with you that there's probably something in the past that might have, but maybe not. It sounds like that she's just been this way since they got married.
And if it is because she's so fantastic in bed or whatever, he needs to make a statement. He needs to make a press announcement to say, yeah. Ladies and gentlemen,
the reason I behave like this, it is the greatest POA I've ever had.
She sucks my right. D like you wouldn't believe.
I'd like to know if people in Sacramento, if he's covered all the time, does he come off as stupid or maybe dim?
I think probably the diehard fans would give us a little perspective.
I'd love to know.
Hope so.
We'll find out. Hi, Don and Mike show.
Hey, guys.
Either way, hey. Listen. Now, hold on. Just give me a second here, my friend. We got to get this guy on the show. We've been on in Sacramento for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
We're the highest-rated show on the radio station. We're proud about that. We always, even though these guys do their dance.
The King Station. Got to get him on the show and ask him, why?
You know, even if
why?
Even if he wants to come on and try to explain to us why he's so pussy-whipped.
Yeah.
I say, and it, you know what? I'll say this. If he doesn't have the balls to, I bet his wife has the balls to.
Sure.
So I'll say to you out there, what's her name? Jackie?
Jackie.
Yeah, right. Jackie? Hey, Jackie, in between scratching your nuts and driving to the arena today to watch your husband to make sure he doesn't look at another woman, why don't you call us up? Phone number is 1-888-I'm-a-bitch.
Oh, God.
Call up. I dare you to call up. You dumb C. My God, what if the game is on the line and this guy misses the shot?
Danny, or he breaks a finger putting up one of those hand signals.
Yeah. Well, but what if he misses the shot? Yeah. Do you think?
Do you think like he's scratching and picking his nose sometimes that maybe the signs can be misinterpreted?
Do you think maybe if he wasn't concentrating so much on waving to his wife?
What are his stats? Is he a good? Solid performer?
I think he's like the sixth guy. I think he's like an off the bench guy.
Oh, he
Bibby. Although I think Bibby,
well, maybe if he's an off the bench guy, then he can get away with this because he's not as significant to the team.
I've heard the name though.
Right.
They got a bunch of role players on the team.
Okay.
They got like one or two stars, and they got all these other guys that come off the bench.
Well, I tell you, it's making the NBA more interesting to me.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, he's a starter. He definitely starts.
He's a starter. Okay.
Starting.
But last year in the Sacramento Magazine, they had a bunch of the players with their wives in different pictures. All of the guys are behind their wives. The wives are sitting. Christy had to sit on the ground with his legs crossed, and she was standing over him like she just slain the lion. It was absolutely amazing.
We're getting more information on them now. Hello, Matt, Don, and Mike. Hi, Matt.
Hey, Don. Hey, Mike.
Hi,
hey. Basically, what it is. Christy's wife was on Oprah one time, and she was talking about this. The family's really, really religious, and they just said that that's how they both decided how to handle
the
NBA.
Let me stop you right there.
The New York Times article that Don just read, she said that it's not a religious thing.
And let me stop you right there. I guarantee it is not a choice that both of them made.
Mm-hmm.
I guarantee when he got married, he didn't say, you know what would be delightful? if we set up a rule that I could never look or speak to another woman.
Or if I was going to be interviewed by a female reporter, you had to clear it and you had to be there if it was the type of woman you didn't want the games with. So I guess with the ugly women, reporters are able to interview him?
Oh, and incidentally, when I'm on the road, I want you to be there. And I even want you to be on the plane with me and the guys on the team. And then when I get on the bus with them to go to the hotel, get a rental car and follow me. And while we're en route, let's stay in constant contact with our cell phones.
You know, if we ever do get the answer, I'd like to know what time of the evening she removes the genital cuff.
Hello, Don and Mike show. Hello. Are you there?
Don and Mike?
Yeah, hi.
What's happening, man?
Hey.
This is Brown. Hey, so you also made him, after they got beaten in the seventh game a couple of years ago in the Western Conference Final against the Lakers,
yeah.
She made
him cut his hair to be more intimidating, which was last year because the Lakers said that he was, the Lakers said that he was bitching out and looked like a deer in the headlight. He passed down a couple of open, wide open shots, and then the shots that he did take, he shot air balls. So she said that.
So she made him cut his hair
all year long. And he's a pretty boy with curly hair, and she made him cut all his locks off. So
All right, thank you, my friend. Hello, Don, on my show, Dennis.
Hey, how you guys doing?
We're doing very well, thanks.
Good. Hey, I want to say the whole thing with the Shaq deal. Last year when Shaquille O'Neal was having a real problem with his foot and it was really sore, some reporters were asking him, hey, are you going to be able to go the next few games? And he said, yeah, it's going to be okay. If it acts up, I'm just going to have Doug Christie's wife massage it for me.
Shaq. Except, you know, what he said, it was probably like,
No, Chrissy Watt massage for me.
That's great.
What do you think about that, Dennis? How you doing? What's up, Doc? How you doing? Hey, Christy, have your wife come over here. I'm going to sign my toe. Why didn't they call Radio Shack? How you doing?
Oh, my God.
Okay,
it gets better and better.
Yeah.
Yeah. We asked the question. We don't have a picture. What does he look like? Chris, what does this guy look like?
He looks like a tall, mulatto, ugly Kevin Bacon. That's what it looks like. He is one ugly dude, man. Wait till you see him, man. Watch the game tonight. You'll be
Now, look, I've gotten some argument here, and I'm just looking at her picture. I think she's a fetching woman. I think she's very attractive. But then I've heard that she's kind of Amazon-like, that she's a strapping woman.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, picture obviously is a glamour shot. So you don't.
And if that's a glamour shot.
Well, I just think she's good-looking. I think she's very good-looking.
Has to be. I don't. No, first off, her hair is way too butch.
I think it is a butch haircut.
My Lord, you are a strapping young woman.
And she just has the look that says the C word.
I'm in control.
I mean, you look at her, she's like, you will go. Couldn't you see her saying, like, I'm going to put this over the microphone now, so I'll be here.
Have you been bad?
Did you talk to Susie Colbert from ESPN? Did you?
She got the evil eyes. Draw a couple of horns on that. And tell me that doesn't look like evil eyes.
All right, hold on.
She does have evil eyes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Hold on.
He's doing it.
I just gave her some yes, double horns.
Yes, he does. That looks perfect.
Now I mean, it really looks like it fits.
Like, if you've seen Dogma, you know the guy in Dogma?
Right.
I don't know that actor's name. He's fantastic, though. The guy who takes off the white hat and he's got the horns underneath.
She really gets mad when you step on her tail.
Oh, wow.
All right, hold on a second.
Fascinating.
There you go. Now I've drawn the tail on there as well.
Good job.
Hello. Mike Show. Hello. Hello there.
Speak to us.
Hello.
Yes, hi.
Hi.
Past your bedtime. Is it an old-timer?
You got me.
What time is it out there? It's 2:35 in the afternoon.
What's going on? Talk to us. What?
Well, I'm a old-time listener now, right? I think you guys have got it all wrong.
Really?
I've watched the game now for 2-3 years, and I think that he is a Catholic, and that he makes that up and down and crosswise shot, and then he touches his lips. And that's the Catholic, help me God, I'm going to go to, and they did it in the World Series. All the athletes.
I think this is different, sir.
Listen, old-timer, a lot of guys cross themselves, and I've seen that before. Uh-huh.
That's what Christie does.
Does he cross himself?
Yes, he does.
He may, but he also signals his wife.
Well, now that putting the arm up in the air, that's something else. Uh-huh. Now, listen, here's something that's never been told about Christie. He is the best stealer in the business.
When is the last time you had a solid bowel movement?
I tell you, now listen, young man. I'm a week ago, I was nonagenarian plus one.
What did you say? How old are you?
I'm a nonagenarian plus
You're 90.
You're 91 years old?
Yes, sir.
Boy.
I say the same question with due respect that has earned a man who's over 90. When is the last time you had a solid BM?
Every day. I take a fiber that's like Metamucil.
That'll do it. Good for you.
Good for you.
You know, the motto of the Don and Mike Show, from the womb to the tomb.
Womb to the tomb, and I believe in recent memory, this may be our oldest listener. Mm-hmm. And congratulations, sir.
Well, I don't know. I've talked to you before.
Oh, you have?
Yes. Let me do just a...
You know my name?
No, what's your name?
Dead Man Walking?
Oh, God.
S.P. Bigfoot.
S.P. Oh, you've seen Bigfoot?
I don't see him. You're talking to him.
Listen, do me a favor. Say hi to Rod Roddy, because you're going to be seeing him.
Oh, my God.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening.
Bye-bye.
I wonder, when they remarry yearly, does he have to put a new ring on her hoof?
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, Don. Hey, Mike.
Hey.
What's going on?
Hey. You know, we're just blown away by the fact that this
is a fascinating story.
The most fully-whipped athlete in the history of the world.
I got more on the bunny cooker for you.
Okay.
It's a fatal attraction.
Ah, that's funny.
Hold
on, hold on. Yeah. That's prize worthy.
Sure is. The bunny cooker.
That is prize worthy. Oh, and
I won't be ignored, Doug.
How wonderful this is. We're talking about sports. You won the NBA prize pack.
Outstanding.
Order NBA League Pass. Go to Cox.com, your friend in the digital age. And we're also going to give you the Sopranos complete fourth season DVD box set. And that is courtesy of whoever puts that out. There's no slug on there, so enjoy. Anyway, what about this guy, the pussy whip guy?
Well, the bunny cooker last year at the end of the Lakers game, that he got in a fight with Rick Fox, when they were walking down through the tunnel, his wife jumped in and got into it with Fox.
Well, of course, you probably would kick his ass.
Yeah.
But, Mike, you were asking, is it a distraction to him?
Right.
He made all-team first defense.
Really? So he is playing at a very high level.
He's a stud.
Okay. Mm. All right. Okay. When she jumped on Rick Fox, did she use her pitchfork?
Hello, Don and Mike show. Hello,
yeah. Don and Mike.
Yeah.
Hey, what's going on? Doug Christie. He's a solid defender, but offensively, he sucks, man.
Maybe here's the thing. Maybe the guy is good enough.
I think he's good enough where they have to tolerate that.
Yeah. Where people go, okay, so his wife is a bitch, and it's like just it's another, you know, because when you think of Sacramento, you think the Kings, mm-hmm. and then, you know, let's be honest, we've been there.
Mm-hmm.
What else is there?
The Kings.
So you got the Kings.
Tomatoes.
So let's say you've got the Kings, and mm-hmm. they're a great team, and you've got this guy who's real pussy whip, but he's a good player. Why are you going to be opening up your mouth and talking about
sure.
it?
Sure.
Why are you going to let the rest of the world?
But I think we owe this to the men of America to actually expose this.
Yeah. And listen, incidentally, all you men in Sacramento, you are just as bad. That you're the sentries.
Don't ignore this.
You guys are out there on the front line. You should have been reporting this to us as soon as you knew this was happening.
Absolutely.
Don't let her get away with this.
Don and Mike show. Hello. Hello.
Hello?
Yes.
This is Tracy Gerald of Sacramento. I'm calling.
Hi, let's talk about the bitch.
I don't know if she's all that. She's the girl that got fired is 50 times more attractive than her, got a body better than her, and she just, you know, Doug Christie's wife isn't happening. And he's brutal on offense, like everybody's been saying.
Right, now it's going to come friend. Out.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, that's what that answered my earlier question about, was the lady that was fired a hottie, and that seems significant.
And it does appear from this picture on her website that she has an Adam's apple. Now that is, you know, that's the tell. If you're ever in a bar and you see a gal uh-huh. and you're wondering if she you know, used to be a
you know, Rob, it's a collarbone, but I'll tell you right now, let's pretend it's an Adam's apple.
Right, one last call. Don and Mike, hello. Hello there.
Don and Mike.
Yeah, you're on the air. Hi.
Hey, guys. How you doing? Hey, everybody has it all wrong. The reason he points to the air is because he's saying goodbye to his son that him and his wife lost a few years back when he first got out of
college.
Okay,
hold on a second. Hold on. If all of that is true, then why is there a story in the New York Times about all of this crap? And if he lost his son, why is she following him around on the team plane and on the bus and surprising him on the...
The article in the New York Times...
I got a good reason for that one, Don. I got a good reason.
Yeah.
On that one, he's pussy whipped.
There you go.
You. All right, so, on that one.
Thank you very much. You were mostly right. Yeah.
Hello, Don and Mike show. Hello.
Hello.
Now, here's a guy. This will be the last call we take on this. If Joe has screened this correctly, this guy is a ticket holder for the Kings, and she sits in front of him at the game.
Okay.
That's exactly right. You guys are way off base. This is it's a great couple and a great guy and a great gal. And
here's all I have to say, too.
That's just pure rumor.
Any couple out there?
What you got on here is just pure garbage.
You lose your son? Man, that's careless.
I didn't lose my son.
No, I'm talking.
You know, the deal is here. I mean, the fact is, there's an article that was in the New York Times about the hand signals and following around.
Funny. That's funny, Rob.
What do you say to that? What do you say to that?
Well, there's guys that do that all over the NBA.
Listen, that guy's pussy whip, sir.
Well, so what? I mean, so are you. You call your wife every day.
Yeah, but finally I found a guy that's more pussy whipped than I am.
Well, so what? He's got a great gal and
maybe
so
that's
too,
the way,
there's
maybe
no reason to trash him.
Maybe that's the way. That's the way we should do the whole show. Just say so what.
No, I think the guy's a skilled player. She's a wonderful gal, and all this crap that's coming across the air is...
You know what? You're a pussy, too.
Well, yeah, right.
You're a pussy, too.
Well, you know, the next time you show up in Sacramento, we'll have a
conversation. Oh, again, now listen, we've tried to move past this. Besides, think how unfair it would be, the headlines. Famous national disc jockey beats dying man to death.
Yeah, there you go.
I mean, think about it. That's bad pub for me.
Yeah.
That's bad pub for me.
We don't need it. You don't need it.
You guys need to get something hotter than this on the air.
Listen. Hey, well, let me tell you something about this. This is a comedy radio show.
Hey, listen,
we are having fun with this story.
You're trying to be way too serious about this, and this guy is pussy whipped, and you must be pussy whipped too. Why don't you go like the dog that you are and do whatever it is that your wife is ordering you to do right now?
Is that right?
Isn't that right? Old people. This is why when I'm elected king, you won't be around. How old are you, dude? How old are you?
I'm 59.
See, the 91-year-old was hipper than this guy.
Yeah. Absolutely, yes. Yeah. Absolutely.
Sadly, well, you just got to get the right stuff instead of a bunch of innuendos on your
There's no innuendos.
I guess the innuendos with the websites and all of the newspaper articles, those are all BS?
Well, go meet the gal. I mean, what the hell?
I've
invited the bitch to come on the show.
Well, maybe she will.
But what do you think of some of the things? You think that everything that we've been reading out of this article and everything that we've had reported by people calling is untrue?
A hell of a lot of it is.
Like what? Then let's be specific. Tell us what you think is untrue.
Well, I've sat behind her for 4 years, and I know the personality of the gal.
No, that has nothing to do with it.
You know what you are, then? You're a stalker. Do you know her? Do you know her personally?
Would she say that you knew her?
Would sit right behind her.
She doesn't know you from Adam.
So how do you know when he's making the signs that he's making them to her or not? How do you know that she doesn't follow the plane and follow the bus?
Well, so what if she does? That doesn't.
Then he's pussy whipped.
Oh, well,
that's what. So what?
Yeah. Well, at least he's got a relationship with his wife that is true and honest. I don't know.
Wait, hold on a second. We're not making any assumptions about the relationship at all. We are reading about 68 hand signals during a game to your wife, and we're reading a fact that she follows the team bus,
and that
she flies on the team plane.
And she doesn't allow him to be interviewed by female reporters.
Don't you think that's a little over the top?
Well, maybe she doesn't want a female reporter in the locker room. I don't know.
Oh, God.
You know what? You might as well just cut your penis off. You are worthless as a man. I mean that.
Yeah.
I mean that.
And you don't know her. You don't know her. You sit in the stands, several rows back.
You're some schmuck that sits behind her and goes home at night and says, hey, did you see, what's her name? Did you see Jackie Christie? Oh, man. You work your man.
You know what pisses us off is when somebody like you doesn't get the joke.
Yep.
We're having fun with this.
And you can have an opinion, because opinions are like a-holes. Everybody's got
but
one.
But, I mean, don't you know, I mean, if you've ever listened to this radio show and you know if you're listening to the gist of this radio show, we're having fun with this. And every guy that's married or been married has to understand this. It's funny.
And he's pussy whipped.
Oh, yeah.
He is pussy whipped to the nth degree.
Well, you can call a guy pussy whipped, but
Don
I don't think
he has called himself pussy whipped.
Call somebody the C word. I think that's definitely.
And I would, and you know what? I'm going to delete this out. But for your purposes, I'm going to.
Really?
Did you get that? I said the word. I had to delete it out. And not only is she that word, she's that on ice.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
She's a C on ice.
Wow.
She won't let him talk to other women.
She won't let him look at other women.
Isn't that a little like a prisoner?
I don't think so.
No,
of course you would. You know what? You're not being honest.
My God, listen, God, answer me this. Why is Rod Roddy dead and this man is alive?
Talk to her.
No
this
justice.
Makes no sense.
You don't, you know what, you don't, you haven't answered any of the points in this. You haven't said anything specific.
You
the only thing that matters to you is that you sit behind her.
And you play pocket pool four rows behind her at the game, you pathetic piece of garbage.
Well, next time you want to come out and sit right behind her at the game, let me know. I'll give you up my seat.
I tell you what, when I go out there, I'll be sitting on the team bench because I'm a happening guy.
Well, they got 3 seats they give away over there.
All
right.
Yeah. I'm a happening guy. I'm pussy-whipped, and I'm happening.
Go out tomorrow, see if you can purchase a sense of humor.
Old before his
and
time.
Try to buy a set of balls. Or has your wife got yours locked away? My wife has mine locked away. I honestly admit that. But at least my wife doesn't follow me to work.
Well, it might be good. I don't know. She shows up on the radio every day on the phone. Hold on a second.
Yeah.
No, hold on. I'm getting my testicles back.
Got to make a left turn.
Absolutely.
He got the signal off.
His hat's getting in the way. lighten up, sir.
What was that, Wilfred? Did you have anything else?
All right.
Mr. Brimley?
Lighten up.
Mr. Brimley?
Yeah.
Keep it light.
Was there anything else?
No, that was just about it, guys.
All right. Well, listen, let's not talk again until your untimely death. Okay?
All right, guys.
All right. Wrap it up.
Pick on somebody else today.
Yeah, all right.
Pardon me? What was that last bit of advice?
I say pick on somebody else today.
You know what? Your goal was to have us stop talking about the Christies. We've certainly been picking on you for a while.
Well, that's all right. I got broad shoulders.
So, in a way, you've done your job.
And I believe that a guy who plays NBA basketball is tough enough to take some criticism from a couple of fat disc jockeys.
Especially if he's good.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So, why did you stop? Listen, exactly when in your life did you stop worrying about all the problems you have, and I'm guessing you got your fair share, and started worrying
right
about everybody else's?
Right up to the time that you walk up to a guy. I mean, how many guys have you ever walked up to face-to-face and said, you know, your wife's a C? Have you done that? Huh?
Yes.
Well, you do.
I have. And listen, hold on. Wife, maybe?
Hey.
What is your wife's first name?
Why? What's the difference does that make?
Well,
you're making it personal. We can make it personal, too.
I
don't know Mike's wife's name.
No, I'm talking about your wife. What is your wife's first name?
Why would you want to know that?
But, please humor me.
Please humor you.
Please humor me. You know my wife's first name. What is your wife's first name? She's... Now, I had to delete that habit. But you tell me that's not funny.
The guy finally...
Goodbye, old man. Right. I say, what's your wife's name? He says, what does it matter? What does it matter? I say, what's her name? What does it matter? Mary. And this is very matter-of-fact. Mary is a C.
It's all
and you know
words.
What he did?
It's words.
He laughed.
He did.
Yeah. Yes, he did.
He did, which was a very unusual response.
I was surprised.
Because it's true.
Because it's true. Oh, my God. Wow.
That was fun.
All right.
Okay.
Well, that's that.
That's I think we've guaranteed a big rating for that game tonight.
I hope so.
And I'm going to write it in my notes that tomorrow we will have to comment.
Comment, see if we observe anything and see if we can see any of these stuff that's been written about in the New York Times.
Oh, my God.
Well, now, Mike, that's all, you know.
It's all in the end,
dude. Yeah, we'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Ooh, Halloween's coming, and it's time to get rid of those scary old phones. Switch to Singular and treat yourself to a new phone.
Ooh, very scary. Get the Sony Ericsson T226 free after a $20 mail-in rebate.
I'm going to go off the script here for a second, Mike.
Go ahead.
The people at Singular Wireless. They love the endorsements, and I want to tell you...
those good people.
I was just talking with Jackie Christie.
Yes.
And she said when she's keeping tabs on her husband, who plays for the Sacramento Kings, that she constantly follows him and calls him using her
Singular Wireless and Sony Ericsson T226. She loves the
picture caller ID and the downloadable polyphonic ringtones.
Yes, she called 1-866-SINGULAR, or she logged on to singular.com, or she visited any Singular Wireless store to get all those phones that help her stalk her husband.
So right there, I'm telling you, you want an endorsement, there it is. Uh-huh. Jackie Christie says certain restrictions apply. See any Singular Wireless store for details. Ooh, this is a scary commercial because it's Halloween time.
Ooh! Tell them Donna Mike sent you.
Jackie Christie. W-J-F-K.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Listen, my friend. I am a supporter of the gay community. I wore a red ribbon to the Emmys. I have been to several Elton John concerts.
What does that mean?
Elton John is a gay.
The Don and Mike Show.
We're going to dance. We're going to dance. We're going to dance. And have some fun.
These please remember to wake them and feed them a cherry pie? Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
I call as my next witness.
Jill's not just a name, it's an idea.
OJ. Which, of course, is Joe in Pig Latin.
Fathers expect more from a kid named Joe.
OJ, if you got a moment to join us here in the studio. On tomorrow, what we're going to do is tape the game tonight, the Kings game on ESPN. And we'll before the show, somebody, hi Rob, will count the number of times that this guy waves.
Very good.
Waves to his wife.
All right.
And we'll see. Here is Joe Ardinger. And hi, Joe.
Hello.
Tell you why Joe is with us. First off, we're not getting a MILF game today. Wow. We're not doing that today. Maybe tomorrow. No, not tomorrow. Next week we'll do it. We're just too jammed up.
Right.
We have the Craig Wilson column, and we had a great fun with Robert Mailman, Bobby Mailman, reading it last week.
Right.
Joe, I was thinking you could read it this week, but first we need some help. There is what's known in the business as a spec spot.
Yes, a spec spot is when you record a commercial and you play it for the client's approval.
Now, part of the deal that we have with Westwood One, the reason we don't complain about them anymore, is that they pulled up a truck full of money in front of our house,
right,
and they said, stop complaining about stuff. Mm-hmm. We'll fix this. We'll make it right, but you guys got to play along, and like if we need a spec spot, mm-hmm, cut the spec spot.
And we play along as best we can.
Now, right. Now the client is Gillette, and from what I understand, they've already bought the advertising schedule.
Hmm.
They just want to know what the spot will sound like.
Sure.
So, Joe, if you would please, we always do these, Mike starts off and says, hi, Don, and I say, hi, Mike. If you would just, for the network, just read that. You can just read both.
Now, is he going to read it with Charlie?
No, it's just Joe.
Just Joe.
Just Joe.
Okay.
Joe playing both parts.
Hi, Don. How come nobody likes to talk about sweat and smell? Hi, Mike. That's right. We all do it, but nobody wants to talk about it. What's the problem? Well, if you're using Right Guard deodorant, there is no problem because you don't have to worry about sweating and smelling. Right Guard provides long-lasting odor and wetness protection so you can go on with your little dry, odorless life without us making fun of you. Now that's reason enough to use it. Right Guard, right to the end of the day. For more information, visit rightguard.com.
Wonderful job,
now,
Joe.
If I'm not mistaken,
you got another copy of that?
I got a copy right here.
They think we actually have to do one.
All right.
Hello?
That's not good enough. Mike and I have to do one?
Yes, you and Mike still have to do one.
Mm. Okay. Hey, do you hear that ringing? That's crazy. Where's that coming from?
It's coming from the phone you're calling. I picked up the same line you're on.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Just to be, and you know what, ladies and gentlemen? He did that just to be difficult.
Right.
So, Joe, don't go anywhere. Now, I don't know why we have to do a spec spot, but
remember what we are now.
That's right. We're team players.
We're team players and we're cooperative.
Right. Hey, Mike.
Hey, Don.
How come no one likes to talk about sweat and smell?
Oh, that's right. We all do it, but nobody wants to talk about it.
What's the problem?
I don't know.
If you're using Right Guard deodorant, there's no problem because you don't have to worry about sweating and smelling.
Right Guard provides long-lasting odor and wetness protection so you can go on with your little dry, odorless life without us making fun of you.
Now, that's enough reason to use it. Right Guard, right to the end of the day. For information, go to rightguard.com. And then, you know, if they have the balls to leave this tape on after they play it for the client, here would be my suggestion.
Mm-hmm.
Hi, everybody. It's Don from the Don and Mike Show. Do you smell like ass?
Oh.
and then go into the spiel.
Absolutely. Ass smell is not a simple problem to correct, but with Right Guard, it will go away, and your friends won't have to tell you that you smell like butt.
Say. You smell like ass.
I used to, Don, each and every day until I discovered rightguard.com.
Okay, so there you go. That's for the network. Now, Craig Wilson, you know, I'm looking at all this. Joe, it's 2 pages worth of copy.
Wow.
We're going to get to buzz in the news. Would you like to do it in a gay voice or in your regular voice? I vote for the gay voice.
I'd like to hear Joe's personal, unique interpretation.
I'll try to pull it off.
And I'll tell you that today the Craig is not over the top gay, but it has the moments that we enjoy.
It has overtone.
Now from today's USA Today, here's the final word with Craig Wilson. Today being read by OJ.
Here's a task you can't brush off. Picking a wall color. I was on vacation last week. I didn't go to Big Sur or Big Sky Country or Big anything. I went to my living room and painted the wall. Actually, I painted the downstairs hallway, which leads to the stairs, which leads to the living room, which leads to the upstairs hallway. In short, I painted half the house. The estimate for the job was larger than my freshman year college tuition, so I decided to relive old times and save some money at the same time. I painted my way through college. I know how to do it. And, like irony, I find it therapeutic. You can see where you've been. It looks fresh and new as you move along. And you have a sense of accomplishment about the whole thing when it's finally over. Although I'll confess at times, that doesn't come soon enough. The much more difficult task is picking the color. Millions of us go to the paint store every year, pick up paint chips, take them home, then wonder why the color we pick has nothing to do with what ends up on the wall. There's a cosmic joke here somewhere, but no one is talking. One paint chip last week was even named Happily Ever After. I thought it ironic because most everyone I know never lives happily ever after once the paint is dry.
Joe.
Most of us, choosing a wall color is more nerve-wracking than choosing a spouse because the color will probably hang around longer. We even raised the stakes. We chose yellow, probably the most difficult color of all.
Shock. Shocked that Craig and Jack would choose yellow.
Should it be sweet butter or sunny days, popcorn kernel or golden grow? What a difference a shade makes. For weeks, we lived with paint chips tucked behind picture frames propped up along the back of the sofa. Every day, the light changed, the colors changed, the minds changed. We finally settled on number 311 of the Benjamin Moore Classic Collection, Squish. I didn't really like the name. It sounded like a mess on the floor of a farmer's market. I like sweet butter better. Sweet butter better. But sweet butter was too dark. I've always wondered who makes up these names. Who gets paid to sit in a room and look at a paint chip and decide that 174 of the Benjamin Moore card is going to be Sunflower Fields? Or 315 is going to be Oxford Gold. What's Oxford Gold? I still don't have a clue, other than that it's too orange for my taste. Then again, maybe not. Our neighbor Elizabeth fancied herself a paint maven, proclaiming that light colors dried darker and dark colors dried lighter. Maybe it was the other way around. I could never remember. Whatever it is, the rule to follow is this. You can't judge a chip by its color. We painted our living room a bright canary yellow.
Hold on, Joe. We got to do a review. Yeah.
And I just want to say, outstanding performance.
Great job.
And now back from the USA Today, the final word by Craig Wolf.
Here's Joe Artinger.
That's right by OJ. You got to wait, Joe. Hold on. There you go. Pick it up.
We painted our living room a bright canary yellow 10 years ago. I had seen the color in magazines, then saw it at a friend's house. Loved it and decided to take the plunge. Her only advice was not to stop once I started. It would look shocking at first, she said, but I'd get used to it. She was right. It was shocking, but I never got used to it. We actually lived with it for a few years, but we finally realized we weren't canary yellow kind of people. I'm not sure we're squish splash kind of people either. But as a reader reminded me in an email just last week, life is too short for white walls.
Outstanding!
There you go, Joe.
The auditor
reads the final word. OJ.
Nice.
I believe
done.
A natural.
Yeah.
And I don't want to tip my hand, but stand by next week for Gay Timmy O'Bibinet.
Oh, all right.
Wow. Nicely done. Thank you, Joe.
Very nice, Joe.
There he is. Remember, his name in big Latin is OJ.
And you know, a pretty damn good column, too, from Craig Wilson.
Yeah.
Yeah, it had all the stuff, those colors.
Yeah.
Would it be sweet butter or sunny days? Popcorn kernel
or golden grown?
Golden grown.
Squish squash.
Shock. Shock, it's yellow is the color of choice.
We're not canary yellow kind of people.
I beg to differ.
Anyway, that's Joe, and thank you, Joe and Craig, and now here's Buzz.
In a world world where owning a radio was strictly forbidden, one man found a way to bring good news to his people.
Here he is.
That's me.
He made it up.
It's Buzz. Mm-hmm. Buzz, your lead story?
Today, you mentioned him earlier on the show, Rod Stewart's doing a much younger woman, but he's still a bitter man.
Hmm. You know, this is good because we're talking about this crappy Rod Stewart album that
exactly,
I've seen right. the ad for where he sings standards. Okay. Mm-hmm. Rod Stewart in the news.
Yep. In the news.
Oh, and hold on. I've got the listing of that CD that I was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
As Time Goes By.
Yeah.
The Great America by Rod Stewart.
Right.
He sings I'm in the Mood for Love. A duet with Cher. Bewitched, Bothered, and Bewildered.
Oh, boy.
I Only Have Eyes for You.
Ah.
Someone to Watch Over Me.
Dentist's Office.
Is he dying?
And a duet with Queen Latifah, As Time Goes By. Wow. What's wrong with Rod?
What happened? He's a rocker.
Rod?
Come on.
Stay tuned for news and comments coming up on the Don and Mike Show.
That was very
professional.
An airy yellow.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
What's the word from Planet Crackpot?
The Don and Mike Show.
Hold it, fellas. That don't move me. Let's get real, real gone for a change. It's the Don and Mike Show.
Yep. And here's Buzz now. Buzz is a new show brought to you by Veramax Sexual Pleasure and Performance Enhancer. It's doctor developed.
Someone call for a doctor.
Clinically tested. Veramax works. Get it at Rite Aid, GNC, other select retailers. Try it today. Veramax 1-888 try. D-Max, and now here's a buddy Buzz. Hi, Buzz.
Hi, Donna Mike. Rod Stewart's been raising eyebrows again, this time over the strange relationship he seems to have with his latest girlfriend. Penny Lancaster is only 8 years older than Rod's oldest daughter. But the weird part is, she calls him Daddy, and he refers to her as his daughter.
And the problem is what?
He says these are just terms of endearment. But quoting her, sometimes I slip up and call Rod Dad. He doesn't mind. He sees it as a compliment.
And Buzz, we had mentioned that the album.
Mm-hmm. Yes, of the old standard songs.
And they weren't even, you know, I mean, I like standards as much as the next guy, but I didn't even like those
I got it
those
here.
Choices.
Hold on.
Some rock stars seem to do this.
What was the one that was, Jesus, I don't have it here.
Jesus is just all right with me, Don.
Anyway, here it is, the Rod Stewart album. This is Rod Stewart doing standards.
Rod singing a standard. And, you know, I don't know if it's me. He just doesn't sound like he used to. Do you agree?
Oh, no, I think he sounds exactly the same. Like a rose. Here he is right here now.
But everybody knows.
Gravelly.
Rod Stewart.
She'll get you a dud.
All right, Rooster Hair, let's hear your line now.
You can look. Bet you dead in nighttime.
There he is, Rod Stewart.
Rod Stewart.
Yeah. The Hot Rod Mod Bod.
Mm-hmm. Whatever. Well, Stewart's bitter about the attention he gets compared to the pass given by the media to the likes of, say, Paul McCartney. Both McCartney and Rod Stewart are with women 26 years younger than they are.
And what about the pass Doug Christie has gotten?
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, there's a pass.
There's a guy. He's got to make hand signs to his wife at a basketball game because he's got his nuts in a jar.
Doug Christie.
But quoting Rod.
That's Jeff Christie.
I'm sorry.
Jeff Christie. Cabbage.
Cabbage.
Cabbage. Cabbage.
Baby Blues.
Cabbage. Wilma.
Quoting Rod, what pisses me off is they never have a go at McCartney for marrying a younger woman, but they kill me because of Penny.
Okay, Rod, this is reality now. You're good. You rock it all.
Yeah.
But you're not a Beatle.
Right.
Okay, Rod?
That's it.
That's why Paul gets the free pass.
And you don't. He's also jealous of Sting. Calling.
And also,
him.
There's not those rumors that they had to pump Paul's stomach.
I was wondering if you heard
Rod Stewart?
That.
I was thinking it was Elton John.
Yeah. No, it's Rod Stewart.
Rod Stewart, they pumped...
Allegedly pumped his stomach and got, like, I don't know, gallons of number of white pee.
That's what we hear.
Right? Did you hear it as Rod Stewart or the other?
I heard it from a girl. There was a girl in my high school. I don't know. I guess.
Oh, my God.
God.
Wow.
That's what I heard in high school.
Really?
It was 11 ounces is what I had heard.
Really?
Yeah.
Yee.
I don't remember the girl. I could have to look it up.
Yeah.
Rob.
Rod Stewart is also jealous of Sting, calling him Mr. Serious who helps the Indians, and Elton John referring to him simply as Sharon.
Sorry, that's funny.
They won Grammys. Rod didn't, hence the bitterness. Arnold Schwarzenegger is back in Washington. He arrived here last night to talk with Congress about the fires that are destroying large parts of California.
I decided to stay out of California until the fires burn. Until they burn out. Then I will go back. Punta.
He'd been planning to come here anyway as part of his victory lap, but now he's here to ask for money for rebuilding. In New Jersey, meanwhile, a candidate for state senator is running radio ads featuring an Arnold impersonator.
Yeah.
What makes this news is it's royally pissed off the Republican Party in California. Quoting one typically humorous Republican, the ad was produced without the authorization, consent, or knowledge of Governor-elect Schwarzenegger. We strongly denounce this fraudulent use of the Governor-elect's image.
To anybody listening to us in California, mm-hmm. do you ever wonder why it is that God just selected your state to set on fire? All of a sudden, out of the blue?
Yeah.
I mean, there's 50 states to this great red, white, and blue nation that I bleed, call USA. You ever wonder, though, why out of the blue? Mm-hmm. And I mean out of the blue, clear blue sky. All of a sudden, it's as if God was, and I don't want to put words in God's mouth, but it seems to me God's punishing you.
Mm-hmm.
For voting Arnold Schwarzenegger as your governor. He has set your state on fire.
Some might call that just a rumor and an innuendo, but I believe that's a fact.
Yeah. I call it God getting even.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. You can F with God to a certain point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's got a sense of humor. He even thought it was funny, I imagine, to have Arnold running and have him on the Jay Leno show.
Mm-hmm.
But then when you guys actually went out and did it...
Yeah, well, it's in the article here when they're talking about these wildfires. It says down, I think it's paragraph 3, it says, God said they elected who? Get me my matches.
Four words. Four words for the hooligan who stole Michelle Branch's computer. Are you happy now? Michelle was staying...
Hey, Buzz, with the MTV reference.
Michelle was staying at the...
I know that song.
Yeah.
I heard that song.
Michelle...
She's moody, but not like Avril Lavigne moody.
No, that's right. Well, Michelle was staying at the Aladdin in Las Vegas when her room was burgled.
Oh.
That's...
Hold on, Robbie, what are you doing? I got that thing turned on. What are you...
Sorry about that. I was finding a tape that I...
Are you looking for I Get Jokes?
Yeah, I am.
You know, we got all these things on the computer,
yeah.
And if I leave the button pushed up, you hear...
The change.
Rob is... Right now, he's stuck on I...
There it
just
is.
Just found it. Oh, there you go.
Oh, I get it. I get jokes.
It was worth it.
Yeah. The thief also took her iPod and some cash. Nelly was staying at the Aladdin also, and somebody stole...
Whoa, Nelly!
Somebody stole his jewels, including his tennis bracelet.
Really?
He says well over $1 million worth of jewels were taken from his room.
No, Nelly's room got burgled.
What does it take to be number one? People don't remember number two, number three. That's a Nelly song.
Yeah. Thank you, Nelly.
Both performers were in town for the Radio Music Awards.
Whoa, Nelly!
Now, and incidentally, that was on Monday night, right?
That show. Mm-hmm.
Allegedly, it's a show about radio and the music that radio plays.
Right.
It was run by Clear Channel, which is there are two big radio companies. There's the one that we...
Boo!
We slave for... Yeah, you boo for both of them. There's Infinity, and then there's Clear Channel.
Uh-huh.
And they're both... It's like Coca-Cola and Pepsi.
Yeah.
It's like McDonald's and Burger King.
Right.
It's like, you know, what one does, the other does, and it's the two big giants.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this was a Clear Channel thing, so they had disc jockeys from all Clear Channel stations on this jive-ass TV special.
Mm-hmm.
But one thing happened recently... I was just reading this either yesterday or today that made me laugh out loud, that I've never been a fan of these national contests.
Right.
Where they kind of cheat and they say that they're going to give a big prize away, but they're really just networking with all the stations across the country.
It seemed to me, and our company does it now as well, and I find it's incredibly just distressful to your listeners that you say, every day we're going to give away $5,000 when you hear us play, you know, Stop the Rock or whatever the song. But what you don't know is that across America there are 400 radio stations
mm-hmm.
playing the song at the same time, and it's a national contest.
Yeah.
So your chances of winning are greatly decreased. Well, they have all these stations, including Infinity stations, have to run a disclaimer at some point during the day saying, you know,
this is a national contest where billions of people can win, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, possibly.
Well, one of the things in this contest, one of these contests, these national contests Clear Channel was doing was you would win a trip to Las Vegas or Los Angeles or somewhere,
mm-hmm.
and the odds of winning the bonus prize were astronomical.
Sure.
But you got put into a raffle to win $1 million in cash.
Wow.
Some schmuck won not only the trip, but won the $1 million.
Same thing? Same guy?
Same guy.
Wow.
Oops. Same guy.
They same screwed guy. Up.
Same
that is
guy.
Funny.
Now that is great.
Yeah.
That is great. Because if you're going to do a national contest, why lie to your listeners? Say, listen, we own a bunch of stations and all these markets, and you're competing with all these people, so good luck.
Right.
Dial recklessly.
One schmuck won the whole thing.
Yeah,
that's
not
funny.
Only did he
that's
win the
good.
Trip, but he won the money, and what makes it great is the fact that the money was just like a throwaway, so that the stations could say,
right.
And if you're caller number 100, you'll instantly win the prize pack and qualify for the trip to Las Vegas. And if you win the trip to Las Vegas, you're in the running for $1 million, which apparently has been the addendum to this contest, this national contest that they've done
right.
for 3 or 4 years. Every time they do the contest in an effort to falsely hype it up, they'll say whatever the contest is. You know, when you hear Fun, Fun, Fun by the Beach Boys, call up and caller 100 eventually will win a brand new Thunderbird with a chance. At $1 million.
And it happened.
And it finally happened. And that's too
sweet
great.
Revenge,
that's
yeah.
too freaking great.
Well, now, you know how I hate to cause a panic, but...
Yeah, I know, you hate it.
The sun is hurtling a giant gas cloud toward the Earth.
Now, Buzz, I brought this up earlier today, and you poo-pooed it.
No, I didn't. No, I did not.
No, you didn't. You,
no,
yeah,
I, said,
didn't
I believe my
out.
Exact words were, we will all be killed.
Have you got information to make this story more... dangerous?
The cloud is 13 times bigger than the Earth itself and is headed toward us at over 1 million miles an hour.
Oh,
now,
my God.
It has had no effect. It's supposed to affect electronic devices, mm-hmm. right?
Quoting a Harvard astrophysicist, it's headed straight for us like a freight train. This is the real thing.
All right.
The biggest in 30 years, it's already crippled a Japanese communication satellite. And experts say this cloud of electromagnetically charged particles could significantly disrupt communications and even hamper firefighting efforts in California.
Well, I hope it all goes well.
I think that if anybody is experiencing any disruption in this radio show, they should let us know.
But I don't think it's going to affect us.
We
haven't heard
any effect here whatsoever.
I think it's fine.
I'm doing that gag again where I play the electrical sound effect.
I don't think there's going to be any trouble at all. I think everything's going to be fine.
Now, so far, so good. Right.
Well,
another day, another dollar.
Hey, when's that bitch from Sacramento going to call in, huh?
I don't know. I don't
think she's going to call.
This show.
Might not be able
to get through.
Hold
on. We've got an update
from somebody on the telephone about that contest.
Oh, good.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hey, Don and Mike.
Hey, you know, he's affected by it, too.
Boy, those the
sun explosions.
How are you doing?
We're doing good.
What did we do for you?
Hey, the big boner was they gave away $2 million. Actually, two guys won
hey,
that
Robbie, you got to
turn it off. I can't understand the
game. Oh, don't turn it off.
We got to turn it off.
Okay.
I couldn't hear what the guy was saying. Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Are you there?
Sir?
We're here.
There you
can you hear me?
All right. So about the contest.
Two guys won. They were on the... They were supposed to maybe give away $1 million, and they ended up putting two envelopes in there that had $1 million, so they had these two fags that won.
Wow, that is...
That is amazing!
That is amazing news.
It sounds different.
All right.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. I'm gonna hang up on that guy.
Yeah. Good idea.
Is it the same setting, right, Rob?
Yeah. You want
to
yeah,
la 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 la.
Little Debbie.
Cha la la. Cha la la. Cha la la la. What's that
HR Puffin stuff?
I don't know.
La 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 la.
That's the banana splits.
Oh.
Hey man,
who gave us
the bad acid?
Tastes like flicker.
I like the laughing.
If you really love it,
it's funny too. Now you're tweaking it up.
I know. I should
stop there.
That's fun.
Can we play a game?
Rainy
days and Mondays always get me down.
He wore blue.
revolver.
This is what absinthe feels like.
I thought you said it didn't work, Doug.
Oh, man.
Hey, bring some of it to Shondell's party.
Oh, I wish I could get some in time.
Happy birthday, Shondell.
What happened to that lady
who was supposed to bring in a bottle of this stuff?
I don't know, man. Why is it funnier when Buzz does it than when I do it?
We have to let him do the news.
Like this. It's fun.
Just for a minute or so. Go ahead.
Well, okay. I think it's appropriate to finish this story.
It could also disrupt electrical service and airline navigation. On the upside, the cloud is not harmful to humans and may produce a brightly colorful night sky.
Ooh. Cool.
Very cool.
Very cool.
Hey, play a game.
3, 2, 1.
All right, we're back.
All right, we're back. We're back. The solar flares have stopped for the moment.
That's a good thing.
Buzz, can you hold on a second there, please?
We're
crazy. We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Gosh, I hate to interrupt. It's all been so incredibly fascinating and entertaining and instructive. Really, the time has just flown by.
The Don and Mike Show.
If you put a knick-knack on their whatnot, they'll give you a what for. Don and Mike.
In case you didn't hear, Friday's Halloween. We're doing Joe trick-or-treating for beer and giving away $1,000 here. Don and Mike World Broadcast Headquarters Friday with the marshmallow races. We'll have
after to listen. This is very special.
Oh, yeah. We'll have full information at the top of tomorrow's show on how you can qualify to come down. And we're going through the course now of where people will be running with the marshmallow in their butts.
Setting up the cones.
Special discount. We'll take time off the time if you're a girl and you have the marshmallow in your butt and you run around topless.
Highbrow? You bet it is.
Well, it worked 12 years ago. We're doing it again. And let me just... hi, Charlie.
I just thought, do you think any of the women could use two marshmallows?
Like under? Oh, no. Yeah. He's thinking of both holes.
Oh.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Why, you little dirty
there you
dirty.
Go. Wow.
That's producing.
Charlie Broyhill just woke up. That's producing. And tomorrow, I don't want to set off all the sensors at trailer parks across America, but attention, tomorrow we're going to be playing The Big Lie.
Uh-oh.
The Big Lie, that's right.
Come on, honey, let's get our story straight.
Trailer parks all over America. Because we're giving away a 6-day, 7-night trip for two to Sydney, Australia, courtesy of Fox, and the season premiere of True Calling, which is tomorrow night at 8 Eastern, 7 Central on Fox.
Right. Start ye fabricating.
Come on now.
That's tomorrow, and now here's a guy about that radio contest thing.
Good.
Anthony.
How's it going, guys?
Okay, my friend.
Hey, yeah, I also do a local Clear Channel station here, and when they had that contest going down, I heard the jock talking about it like 87 times a day. And what it was, they gave away 75 trips to Vegas, and every one of those 75 people had the opportunity to win $1 million. So if Clear Channel didn't play their cards right, they could end up giving away $75 million.
Right.
So I guess that one guy just got lucky and ended up winning the million.
So there really wasn't a point to this. I mean, it said can shed on the screen. It says can shed light on content.
I really think we've.
I think we've covered
the Clear Channel story. I really do.
Well, you
I think we've got all. I think I've certainly personally got all the information I ever wanted to know about it.
I'm sorry for wasting your time. I'm gonna beat myself now.
No. Your mom is what?
A teacher?
No.
Come on. No, what are you saying when you make a bad call?
If you're going to eject, what are you saying, Anthony?
My mom's a whore.
There you go. Thank you. Good boy.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Too bad we missed you at the Hard Rock.
Who's the bigger diva, Britney Spears or Mariah Carey?
Mariah Carey? That one-faced bitch?
Mariah Carey is definitely a bigger diva. Winners, both of you. For a recent appearance on British TV, Britney had just one request. Remove the Red Bull, Coca-Cola, and Evian from her room so her sponsor Pepsi wouldn't be upset. Mariah Carey, on the other hand, she checked into her penthouse suite at a world-class hotel and immediately ordered two DVD players so she could watch DVDs of herself. She also ordered 6 dehumidifiers for her suite, plus an extra suite just for her wardrobe. That was after bellboys lugged 43 suitcases up to her room.
Oh, my God!
Plus a trunk full of makeup.
She may be worse than Doug Christie's wife.
By the way, Mariah also demanded that her drinking water be served in chilled plastic bottles only. She said the water had to be Evian. With any luck, it was the Evian that Britney rejected and spat in.
No! I'd say I'd be glad to do that. Just get into this chair. Let me see how bad your poon smells. get her into a gyno chair.
Ooh,
I mean,
no.
If you want to be treated that way,
mm-hmm.
if you want all of those perks, well, you've got to have the sweetest smelling
sure.
garden.
Absolutely.
You know.
It must be absolutely lovely.
Okay. So, I mean, if you have that much attitude
uh-huh.
that you can ask for all that stuff,
right.
I think you're fully within your rights to go down and take a sniff.
thank you, Miss Carey.
Keep that chair handy because...
Something tells me it looked like a fog machine down there.
Courtney Love would just like her daughter and her career back. Things got even worse for her yesterday when she was hit with two felony drug charges, also that Vicodin-fueled attack on herself and some plate glass windows. After the warrants were issued, Courtney turned herself in. She's still behind bars with bail set at $20,000. Courtney insists she's not a bad mother and continues the custody battle for her 11-year-old daughter.
Now, you know, on a sidebar here...
Mm-hmm.
This is kind of like Rush Limbaugh, right? I mean, doesn't she have Vicodin?
Yep. Yeah, Vicodin, absolutely.
She has Vicodin and OxyContin.
So she had cabbage.
Cabbage, plenty of cabbage.
Oh, yeah. Do you think she got it from Wilma?
No, she got it from the Cobain Fortune.
So she is arrested because she's a danger to her kid?
Well, yeah, they took the kid away because she ended up at the house of a stranger and busted out the windows of the house. Apparently trying to get in for refuge or trying to get help.
I need shelter.
Cabbage.
There we go.
And so they dropped the break-in charges, but now she faces these drug charges. And my, oh my, the Doherty family of Cambridge City, Indiana, has done a lot of crop circle-type mazes in their cornfield over the years, but never has one attracted so much attention as the one they have now. It's a cartoon likeness of David Letterman stepping out of an outline of his native Indiana.
Hey, how you doing, pal? You know what? Your brand of comedy reminds me of my mom's mashed potatoes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Lumpy and tasteless.
The maze has already been featured in TV Guide. Dave even showed it on his program. Hundreds of people have toured it. It'll be open through Friday. The admission price goes to the Ronald McDonald House. Other mazes have featured Larry Bird and Peyton Manning, but now the Dohertys say they're stuck for next year. Quoting them, we need suggestions.
Hey, it's me, Dave. I've been doing some early Christmas shopping.
Really?
And I came across a gift that would be perfect for the people who listen to your show.
What's that, Dave?
Earplugs.
That's a staple.
You know, sometimes I'm just so funny, I crack myself up.
That's a staple. That never gets old.
Never.
Right.
Never
I don't know how many years we've been running those bad tapes, like 10 years.
I laugh every time I hear it.
Yep. Never gets old. Right. File that under N. File that under BN or BSN.
What's that?
Brand spankin' new.
You got it.
Bingo.
Yeah.
Brand spankin' new.
Fresh is the day we heard it the first time.
10 years ago.
In sports, one of the most hyped players in NBA history makes his regular season debut tonight. LeBron James and the Cleveland Cavaliers visit Sacramento. The 18-year-old was the top pick in the draft. He's been an NBA prospect since his sophomore
Let's
year.
Let's go, Pussy Whipped!
Of high school.
The Pussy Whipped.
And after their war of words, Shaquille O'Neal and Lakers teammate Kobe Bryant say they have moved on. Bryant, who sat out last night's game, lashed out at Shaq after O'Neal suggested Bryant should pass more until his knee's better. Bryant was fined an undisclosed amount by the team yesterday. And finally, call it 9-1 Wonderwear. In the Netherlands, folks may soon be able to call for medical help using their underpants. The Philips Research Labs in Holland.
I'm sending out an SOS right now. Let's see if you get it. Yes.
Got to work on that response time.
You're way ahead of them. The Philips Research Labs in Holland have come up with...
Send help. Oh, immediately.
They've come up with underpants that monitor your heartbeat, and the pants are connected to a cell phone, which automatically dials 911 in the event of a heart attack or some other medical emergency.
My pants.
They hope initially to market the smarty pants in Holland and Germany. They might consider Sacramento.
Oh, it's Don, the phone.
Incredible!
Is that who answered the phone?
Yeah, it's John Pop's underpants.
Hello, John.
I'm Buzz Burbank on the Don and Mike Show.
Thank you, Buzz.
No!
No!
Yes!
That's it. We got to go tomorrow.
still have to count on the guy with the lady at the game. And Big Lie tomorrow. We got Skin tomorrow. We got Nancy. We've not played the MILF game yet. We'll be talking about the marshmallow races on Friday.
Busy, busy, busy.
That's it. We got to go. We'll see you tomorrow with the new episode. Good day to you, sir.
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 You.
John Pop told me he has Cole waiting in his underwear.
BM.
Eaters.
Till we meet again. This is Sammy Davis Jr. saying, be kind, be nice, and I hope the next performer has the pleasure of having as nice an audience as you've been tonight. And let me leave you swinging.